They call it the granddaddy of them all. It's the bowl against which all bowls are measured. It has pomp and pageantry. It has history and tradition.
Mike Williams throws to Leinert, touchdown.
Look out, Michael for six. He's got the speed.
He's going for the corner. He's got it.
This year's matchup is a stirring clash of styles. It's ultra-conservative.
Touchdown, Penn State!
Versus uber-flashy.
Touchdown, USC!
Living legend versus rising star. It's Big Ten versus Pac-10. Penn State versus USC. This is the Rose Bowl. Once a year they wait here on the West Coast, and once a year they come from the Midwest, and they come for the granddaddy of them all. This is the 95th Rose Bowl game presented by Citi. Penn State will take on USC in a highly anticipated matchup. And welcome to Pasadena, everyone. I'm John Saunders alongside of my partners, Craig James and Doug Flutie. There's one thing we all... Well, not all of us. Some of us love the BCS. I know I like the BCS. But there's one thing that we know at the start of every year, that the Rose Bowl is going to have a traditional Pac-10, Big Ten mashup, and it's going to be great.
It's usually been a great game. You know, it's one of those games you get to come out and watch USC play and how good they are and how powerful they are. You know, if I had a pregame speech right now and Joe Paterno said, talk to my ball club, I'd say, hey, fellas, know this. USC's been playing with their hair on fire since they got beat by Oregon State. You better be ready when you walk into this Coliseum. This is a home game for USC. That's the one thing that I've learned about the Rose Bowl. It's a home game for sure for the Pac-10, especially USC.
I think everybody's waiting to see Ken Penn State match up with USC. USC plays their best football in the Rose Bowl. They are as good as they can be in this game. They usually have that one or two down weeks during the season, but not when it comes to the Rose Bowl. Ken Penn State match up.
And can Penn State specifically hang in there early in the game and withstand that initial blow?
It's going to be a great matchup just the same. Let's take a look at the ESPNU All-State standings. And as you can see, both of these two teams ranked in the top 10. USC at one point was ranked number one in the nation this year, and Penn State ranked number eight. But both took different routes to the Roses. Out in Happy Valley, the roar returned for Joe Pa's Nittany Lions. Behind first-year starter Darrell Clark, Penn State has an explosive and balanced attack that averages over 40 points per game. Their domination of Oregon State was a highlight of their 8-0 start, but the undefeated Nittany Lions were relatively untested, heading into their showdown with the defending Big Ten champs, Ohio State.
Fryer steps up, waits long time, throws a deep downfield in the end zone, and it's intercepted, and the Nittany Lions go into Columbus to come up with the big plays in the fourth quarter.
After a bye week, Texas Tech jumped over Penn State, who remained third in the BCS.
Is it the BCS or the BSC? I don't know. They're going to do. I'm telling you what I'm concerned about. I'm concerned about Iowa, period.
Here's the spot, the snap, the kick is on the way, and it's through! Iowa beat Penn State!
Down but not out, the Nittany Lions rebounded by blowing out Michigan State.
Clark back, pump fakes, he wants the end zone with Derek Williams, makes the catch, touchdown, Penn State! The Nittany Lions win the 800th game in school history, and in the process win the Big Ten Championship for the second time!
The USC Trojans arrive in Pasadena with a defense that's been in the heart of their season with a blowout win over Virginia, which moved them to the top of the polls. In week two, the number one Trojans hosted fifth-ranked Ohio State in a much-hyped affair.
Picked off by Mal Wilder. He's got the ball on the 40. Now the sideline to the 20-yard line. Still on his feet to the 10, to the 5.
Next up for the Mighty Trojans was underrated Oregon State.
Hit, punt, touchdown, Beavers! It's the Beavers.
almost 43 points per game.
Play action for Sanchez. Wines, throws, end zone. Touchdown, USC.
Meanwhile, their bruising defense punished opponents, recording three shutouts in their next four games on their way to eight straight wins.
Trojans have won the Pac-10 championship outright. It is their seventh straight BCS Bowl, seventh straight 11-win season.
Well, we can look at the numbers to see these two teams are evenly matched. But as we look at the numbers, I ask you guys the question, how do you account for the fact that they did have a common opponent in Oregon State? Penn State absolutely annihilated Oregon State, and Oregon State knocked USC out of the number one ranking in the nation.
Means absolutely nothing. If you start comparing and looking at that game, trying to figure out what's going to happen in this game here, you're an idiot. And okay. I know you're a smart guy, John. Love you, man. No, you know, when I look at this team, you know, Penn State specifically, I look at Penn State as a football team that this season, their players on defense told me we had a lot of pressure on us because our offense was so good. It's usually Penn State's defense that we talk about. But their offense this year, the competition that they forced within the locker room, and Joe Paterno's outstanding coaching and flexibility and adjustment to the booth upstairs, taking care of his physical pains, that's what really sticks out to me is what made Penn State so good this year.
What I thought about early on was how balanced they were. They were running the football. Royster running the ball. And then Darrell Clark came along. He's only thrown four interceptions all year. They have to be able to move the ball on the ground. He's got to make some plays with his legs. He's rushed for 9 touchdowns this year. That's Darrell Clark. And if they can just keep from making the negative plays and stay in this game, then go win it in the second half or fourth quarter.
One of the things that also stands out each and every year when we come to the Rose Bowl, we are going to see some of the very best college football players, never mind the teams, players in the country.
Ray Maluga at USC, this defense, 7.8 points a game. They're outstanding. They get after you. His intensity is the thing that impresses me the most about him, and it's contagious. The rest of the players in that huddle, they've got to match what Maluga does every game.
Okay, all the superstars are over there for USC, right? But Aaron Maben, 12 sacks this year. He's the one big name defensively for Penn State. Gets after the quarterback in a group of guys that are kind of a blue-collar group.
I was at USC in the spring the day that Mark Sanchez was announced the starter. And he told me, you know what, Craig, my goal is I want to be the Rose Bowl quarterback again this year. This is a guy that knew his destination, what he had to get done. Because of his presence of mind and ability on the field, the Trojans are playing in the game that he wanted to play in today.
And on Penn State side, it's Darrell Clark at quarterback. Like I said earlier, only four interceptions this year. You add 9 touchdowns rushing to that. He is the guy that has made them a balanced offense to be able to throw the football. So Roy
and Kirk and I certainly wish you and Doug and Craig nothing but the happiest of New Year's. And, you know, they put their finger on the quarterbacks. You and I have talked a lot about how well Darrell Clark has to play against arguably the best defense in the country. But the same is true of Mark Sanchez. I mean, the Nittany Lions play a little defense, too.
Yeah, I think coming into this football game, there's been so much hype and anticipation to see the USC defense going up against Darrell Clark. But you're right, Brent. Mark Sanchez, you see the comparison here. He's got some pressure because of what Penn State's able to do. And that's why I think the running game for both of these teams will be vitally important. Mark Sanchez, 30 touchdowns, 10 interceptions. People ask, what kind of year has USC had? What's wrong with USC offense? I look at those numbers, and I think that's a pretty good year for a first-year starter. And, of course, Darrell Clark, he is the heart, he's the pulse of the Penn State team. I hate to put it all on his shoulders, but he really has to step up tonight, not only play well running and throwing, but also he's got to be the leader that they desperately need in this big a game.
Kirk, how do a couple of outstanding quarterbacks settle their nerves when they're on a big, big stage like this?
The big thing to do is get hit right in the mouth, especially in Darrell Clark's case. He's been reading, he's been interviewed, he's been hearing about how great this USC defense is. The best thing to do for him is to settle down by running the football, get popped, and then just go out and play. Mark Sanchez, this is like a regular season game. This, for him, is what he's waited for his whole life. He'll settle down by making a couple good throws early in the game.
And so, John, there are certainly some defensive players on the field who will hit you right in the mouth. You know that.
Brent, no question about that. And one guy who doesn't get enough mention, perhaps, is Brian Cushing.
You're right. Hey, Herbie and Brent, this is a guy that'll do it to you. Brian Cushing, USC's coaches and players say that he probably had the best season of anybody on that defense. A very dependable player. He will light you up. Smart. A lot of good players around him. So, you know, the USC defense, Doug, I think they're going to be outstanding. This could be a challenge to Penn State's offense.
Yeah, the offense has to run the ball right at him, and Evan Royster is the guy to do it. You have to go north and south. This cannot be an east-west Northwest game. Too much speed on that USC defense. Make sure you're going north and south with the football.
When we come back, we will hear from the coaches, a living legend and a legend in the making.
The way I know Joe, he's a fireball. He's feisty, he's tough. And he's a lot of fun. And I think much differently, you know, he seems so serious all the time when you see him as the football coach, but when you get him away from football, he's the life of the party. And he's a blast.
I think Pete Carroll's one of the best coaches, if not, I mean, when I say one of the best, I'm talking about maybe 3-4 guys in the country who are the best coaches around right now, and Pete's one of them.
Joe Paterno is definitely the best coach, you know, that you can play for, not just with football, but with life in general. You know, I think he strives on taking teenage boys and turning them into men.
But when you end up in a real-life situation and you think about something that Joe's told you, you know, it really comes back to mind, oh, wow, this is really, he's really grooming you to be a man.
He's a friend, you know, he's a family member. You know, he always puts his team and his staff before himself, and I think that is what really separates him from the other coaches in the college world.
That's Joe Paterno. Pete Carroll, on the other hand, was a mere 15-year-old boy when Joe Paterno started coaching at Penn State. But Pete Carroll's becoming a legend of his own. He's standing by with Lisa Salters.
Pete, your guys have been hearing for the last several weeks, Penn State has been hearing for the last several weeks, that they don't have a chance. I know you and your guys don't believe that. What concerns you most about this Penn State team?
I've said all week that they have great balance. You know, all faces of their team are really, really well done. Their offense, defense are great, positioned with their techniques, their tactics. Their players are really good. They got quality guys at the right spots at quarterback, tailback, receiver. I mean, this is a really, really good football team.
And I know you've heard it before, but what do you say to people in this setting, this beautiful day, that USC, they really don't care about this game. This is a home game for them. They'd rather be somewhere else in the national championship.
Well, that's people that aren't with us, at least. I mean, we love to play, and we get a chance to play here in the Rose Bowl. It's a tremendous honor to play here. Anybody else that's talking doesn't get it. So they can say what they want, but this is a thrill for us to be here. We're going to give it everything we've got. We've had a great preparation. The Rose Bowl has treated us beautifully. We've had a wonderful buildup, so now we want to try to celebrate on this day.
All right, thanks for your time, and good luck.
All right, Happy New Year.
I truly believe that the great college coaches, some of it comes from their enthusiasm, as you look down the numbers right here. And we know about the enthusiasm of Joe Paterno. And we also know that Pete Carroll gets about as fired up as any coaches you'll see on the sidelines.
Well, you know, Joe Paterno, it's amazing to me the energy level he has at age 82. Just signed a 3-year deal. He's pounding on the dais speaking at the Hall of Fame dinner this year. We were all fired up. We wanted to put pads on and go to work for him. We wanted to go hit somebody in the mouth, as my buddy was saying earlier. And Joe still has that fire about him. He's still that little athlete out on the field, but now he's on the sideline coaching.
You don't want to get hit, Flutie. If you got hit right now, you can't even get in your chair without creaking over, man. You know what, though? The one thing that on the other side, Pete Carroll, when I watch him in the spring, when you watch him at practice and you see how he handles his football team, the passion and the intensity that Paterno has at Penn State and has had for years, it's the same at USC. Pete Carroll loves intensity. His players who come to play at USC, they expect to go to practice every day, compete every day, and he's jumping up and down like a young kid. I mean, the guy gets them going day in and day out.
Do you remember the national championship game against Texas? You and I are on the sidelines. Pete Carroll standing maybe about 10 yards away from us. He calls us over to him, intense moment in the game, and goes, isn't this great, guys? Isn't this great?
That's awesome. That's the way he is.
Pete would love to throw the pads on and play, don't you think?
No, I don't.
Well, some guys did throw on the pads. They're played already today. Let's begin with the Capital One Bowl, which was played in Orlando, Florida, between Georgia and Michigan State. Matthew Stafford, people wondering, is he heading to the National Football League? Perhaps it's the number one pick by Michael Moore. 35-yard touchdown.
This is in the second half. In the first half, Matthew really was off, and Mike Bobo, the offensive coordinator, and Stafford got together. They made some adjustments. They really came out and took advantage of Michigan State's opportunities that were given to Georgia.
Aaron White that time. This time, no Sean Moreno for a touchdown. 24-12, Georgia comes up with a win in the Capital One Bowl. 6-10 win season in 7 years for Mark Richt. The Outback Bowl. Steve Spurrier and the Gamecocks looking to take on Iowa. Remember, Iowa, the only team that's beaten Penn State this year. Richard Stanzi to Trey Ross. First touchdown of the year. Iowa leads 7-0. Then Steven Garcia throws a pick to Iowa's Tyler Sash, who returns it 16 yards.
You know, South Carolina's turned the ball over all year. 27 interceptions this year for them. But on the other side, Sean Green, another big day. 3 touchdown rushing. Over 100 yards again. The only player in college football to rush over 100 yards every game.
Sean Green announced after the game he's going to the National Football League next year. Gator Bowl. Cullen Harper for Clemson. Remember what a terrible year it was for him starting out. Finds a diving Aaron Kelly for a touchdown.
You know what? I did the game when Clemson played at Wake Forest middle of the season, right as they were about to get rid of Bowden. This team was falling apart. Dabo Swinney has come back and did an outstanding job of coaching and getting them going, just as Bo Pelini has done for Nebraska. They've got an offense again.
Yeah, Joe Gann's leading them back. Finds Todd Peterson there. They get a field goal to get when they won. And then Alex Henry, 28 yards. And Nebraska comes out on top, winning the Gator Bowl 26-21 was the final. That's really a look at a group of teams that we should be looking at next year.
You know what? When you talk about next year, everybody's spoken about it going into the bowl games this year as additional prep time, recruiting time, getting ready for next season, 09. The one thing that I think I've learned through this bowl season is watching football teams when they go into a game, not panicking like Oregon did the other night. Their offense, they were frustrated not getting it done in the Holiday Bowl, stayed the course like Penn State better be ready to do here. Don't panic. Stay the course.
I'd like to just look at the two turnarounds. You know, Iowa turned around, won 6 of the last 7 games, really got it going, jump-started by a win over Penn State. And then Dabo Swinney stepping in and going 4 of his last 6 games, although they lost or are losing today. It's not a final yet.
All right, we want to take a look at the history of the defenses of both of these teams, the Trojans and, of course, the Nittany Lions. Passing yards per game, you're not going to get much. Passing efficiency, you're not going to get much either. Right now, let's join our game day crew, Chris Fowler and Lee Corso.
Yeah, well, John, thank you. Up close for the SC band here. We got the clarinet section behind us. How you guys doing?
Yeah.
Oh, hey, that'll be enough of that. You know, we saw the stats about the SC defense, Lee. Penn State quietly skeptical about the quality of some of those USC opponents. Is the defense really that good?
Yeah, that's a very good point by Penn State. But if I'm not mistaken, isn't a Pac-10 undefeated in bowl games?
Yes, they are.
Yo, 4-0. Sweetheart, that tells you they're pretty good.
Now, Steve Sarkisian hired at Washington. He hired some assistants, did some recruiting before Christmas. Since then, it's been all USC. He's calling the plays. He insists to me it will not be a distraction. Business as usual. We've seen other guys say that, and it has been a distraction in the game.
Well, I think it mentally, no question, it's a distraction. And you can't serve two masters. The guy's a head football coach at Washington in his heart. We'll see how it affects him. Even remember, they're not a great offensive team, even if he was still here.
No, but he's a very good play caller. Would you agree now? When he's in rhythm, SC can be pretty tough to stop.
Very good.
All right. A lot more buzz in here, John, than last year when the Illini were here. This time it's Penn State.
No question, Chris. We'll join you on the sidelines in a moment. We got one more segment to do. My partners here want to make their predictions. Let you know whether it's the Nittany Lions or USC. Time now for the City Rose Bowl Flashback, which recounts the history of Penn State and USC in the granddaddy of them all. Southern Cal has come out victorious in 23 of their 32 Rose Bowls, by far the most wins and appearances. Their most recent victory came just a year ago as the Trojans dominated Illinois. It's been 14 years since Penn State played in the Rose Bowl. It was a 38-20 victory over Oregon, capping an undefeated season.
Goodbye. Touchdown, Penn State. First play of the ball game.
The Nittany Lions' only other appearance was a 14-3 loss to USC in 1923. Are the Trojans primed to win their 24th Rose Bowl, or will Penn State celebrate their third victory in the granddaddy of them all? This is the 95th Rose Bowl, and with Joe Pa here in his 80s, appropriate that the Grand Marshal is Cloris Leachman, also in her 80s. Most recently of Dancing with the Stars fame. And, of course, the Rose Queen. She's a 17-year-old senior in high school by the name of Courtney Shu Lee. Courtney is the captain of her volleyball team and vice chairman of the auxiliary committee. Right now, it's time to look at the Rose Bowl dreams of the two teams that will take the field in a moment.
We're going to have to play a team that I think is one of the best teams in the country. And you know, whether we're good enough or not, we don't know.
It's a complete honor. You know, it's my first Rose Bowl start, January 1st. You know, Pac-10, Big Ten matchup, classic matchup. Joe Paterno, you know, that's the winningest coach in college football history. I'll make sure I shake his hands before the game and tell him how honored I am to be on the field with him.
I can just remember being a kid just playing around the yard saying, this is the Rose Bowl. And those games were the USC's against Penn State, so, you know, it's one of my dreams.
There's not enough Rose Bowls for me. You know, people that talk about that we don't want to be there, or we don't like it, they don't understand. They don't get it. It's all everything does.
No one thought we'd win the Big Ten. No one thought we'd be in the pitcher, and we won it. The country don't think we have a chance against USC out there. I think we can handle trying to go out and prove to people wrong one more time this year.
The dreams of the gentleman on the field, and there's Courtney Chu Lee, who's living her dream as the Rose Queen for 2009. All right, now comes the question. These guys are experts all season long. It comes down to the Rose Bowl right now. What's the key to the game? Who wins the game?
All right, I'm going to go with USC. I'm going to give Flutie a chance to take Penn State.
Yeah, so
I'll take it. I'll go USC. I'm going to go because of their defense. I think USC's defense, which has allowed only 17 plays of 20 or more yards this season, best in the nation. They frustrate Penn State's offense today. So, Flutie Flakes, I've opened the door wide open for you. I'm afraid to pick a winner.
Joe Pine, 86, upsetting Miami for a national championship. So, we're going with Joe. I can't do it. USC is too strong. I don't know. Speed on defense. Offensively, I think USC is a little inconsistent, but still they've been averaging 43 points a game this last part of the year. Sanchez, 30 touchdown bet. USC.
Well, there's one team that's sitting at home that's very interested. Oregon State. They're the team that's played in both. We will see at halftime right now. Let's join Brent Musburger.
Well, John, this is why they play the games. As we welcome everyone to one of the grandest settings in all of sport, we ring in 2009 with one of the most intriguing matchups of the entire bowl season, USC and Penn State.
The milestones of American life, the rituals, the turning points, the traditions, making us who we are, connecting us to each other. One such event, experienced year after year, is the Rose Bowl.
It's tradition.
It's the Rose Bowl.
Once again, it brings together two of the country's storied conferences.
It's Big Ten versus the Pac-10.
From out of the West, the Trojans. So successful in the Pete Carroll era, still going strong, it will go down as one of the most glorious and decorated ever.
We own the Rose Bowl.
And from the East, the Nittany Lions.
We are Penn State.
Whose venerable coach is a symbol of excellence over time. A long time. Joe Paterno continues to inspire his team.
He's an icon, a legend.
And everyone who follows the great game of college football.
It's such an honor.
History in the making.
This is going to be something special to be a part of.
The patterns are all around. The occasions, the events that enrich our lives. And today, the granddaddy of them all.
Pasadena, California, site of a holiday tradition that's brightened the new year for over a century. And on a beautiful, sunny Southern California afternoon, we welcome you to the Rose Bowl game presented by Citi. On tap, the Penn State Nittany Lions, proud and powerful champions of the Big Ten, face off against the team that has simply owned this Rose Bowl in recent years, the USC Trojans, champions of the Pac-10. Happy New Year, everybody. With Kirk Street, I'm Brent Musburger. Pleasure to have you along with us. And, you know, Herbie, you and I were down on the field a little bit earlier. There is just something special about this venue.
You know, we live in an era where the BCS is the hot debate throughout the year. And every year, you and I and our crew come out here to Pasadena, spend a few days, and then walk out here on January 1st. To me, there's nothing like this spectacle in all of sports, not just college football. Just a special game and a special day for these two teams.
Did you smell any special stories, by the way?
You know what, Brent, it was interesting. We knew coming into this game that the speed is such a big advantage for USC, at least on paper. And on the field, listening to the two teams, on one end, USC, they're emphasizing that with their coaches and their players. Today, get a good stretch. It's about speed, speed, speed. And then on the other end, Penn State also talking about the very same thing. I think the Lions feel they match up with USC. They're not running away from this athletic ability of the Trojans.
The focus eventually always comes back to the quarterbacks. Let's start with Darryl Clark, number 17 of Penn State.
Darryl Clark has been much like Michael Robinson in 2005 for Penn State, running and throwing. Now, if you've not seen Darryl Clark play, make no mistake, he is a passer who happens to be athletic. He's not an athletic guy who's learned how to throw this year. He's very, very multidimensional because of his ability to run and throw, but his leadership today, so important for the Lions, especially early in this game. As good as USC is on defense, the Lions have to start fast, and especially number 17.
And on the other side, Mark Sanchez, number 6.
You know, he's paid his dues. He's waited his time to become the guy. He's grown up in Southern California and knew that one day this would become a reality. And now here he is, the starting quarterback for the men of Troy in the Rose Bowl. And in his mind, he's ready to go out and play a game where he's in complete control, making great decisions with the football. And something to note, people talk about him not having a great year and this offense not having a great year. 30 touchdowns with a balanced offense is an outstanding first year for Mark Sanchez, and he's got all of his weapons healthy, which is so important against his Penn State defense.
Yeah, Kirk, one of the things I want to emphasize is the test of wills that we've got here. When you and I watch practice, you'll see that Pete Carroll wants to get to the flanks. He wants to attack with that great speed. Joe Paterno on the Nittany Lions, that offensive line, over and over. Let's settle for first downs.
That's right.
Let's keep it under control for a while.
Yeah, that's going to have to be the over the long haul four quarters. That'll have to be Penn State's philosophy. Same time, they're going to have to take some shots on both sides of the ball to be able to win today.
Okay, Kirk. And let's go down to the field right now. The Spirit of Troy, the Trojan Marching Band, directed by Dr. Arthur C. Bartner. And it is time for our national anthem. Awesome sight of that B-2 stealth bomber. Two of them arrived here Tuesday. They flew in from where they are based in Missouri. One of the bombers opening up the parade earlier today, and you just saw the second one come over the Rose Bowl here in Pasadena. Our weather, it is glorious here today, 70 degrees. Meanwhile, back home in State College, Pennsylvania, 26 degrees. And Lisa Salters is the third member of our team. And Lisa, big stories involving Joe Paterno all week. What has he decided and where will he be during the game?
Well, Brent, I've been down here on the field all afternoon, and the one person, surprisingly, that I have not seen, Joe Paterno. He did not come out into the field at all during pregame warm-ups. He didn't have the traditional midfield chat with the opposing coach, Pete Carroll. He didn't do a scheduled interview that he had with us, even though he was contractually obligated to do so because of our Rose Bowl game deal. Now, I'm told that Paterno, right before he was supposed to come out into the field for stretching and warm-ups with his team, told his Penn State officials, look, I'm tired of all the attention being about me. I'm not going out. He felt that if he came out here, all the cameras would be around him, and he felt that that would be disrespectful to Pete Carroll, disrespectful to USC, and he thought that, quite frankly, it would take all the attention away from his players. Now, guys, I can tell you that Paterno has been on a slow boil about this very issue all week long. He's been asked every day about whether he's going to coach the game from the sideline or up in the box. Just yesterday, I asked Paterno if there was a chance that maybe he could lead his team out into the field and then go up into the box, and he said, stop talking about me, so we could see this coming. By the way, Penn State could be fined up to $10,000 for him not doing that interview, and apparently he doesn't care.
And the Trojans make their annual appearance in the Rose Bowl. Young Mark Sanchez will be at controls. Ray Matabaluga, number 58. You'll see him, the fearsome middle linebacker. Ken Norton, the linebacking coach, keeps the defense fired up. But the youngsters from Central Pennsylvania won't be backing down to anybody. Upstairs to the coach's box, just off to our left from where he will stay for the entire game. And the captains now make their way to the center of the field for the coin toss. Let's go down to our Rose Bowl referees from the SEC conference. He's a good one, Steve Shaw.
Okay, gentlemen, today presenting our corn is the president of the Tournament of Roses, Corky Consonaire. Mr. Consonaire, thank you, sir. This will be our coin today. As you can see, this is the USC logo. The other side has a Penn State logo. We'll let the toss hit the ground. The logo up will win the toss. Okay, gentlemen? Now, we're honored to have Ms. Cloris Leishman to toss the coin for us today. Ms. Leishman, come toss our coin.
That's good.
And the winner is USC. There's your coin. Thank you, sir. USC, you've won the toss. You're going to defer to the second half. Penn State is your choice. You want to receive. All right, they're going to receive. Which gold would you defend? Kick that way. All right, turn your backs here. Penn State over there. USC won the toss and will defer. Penn State well received. Gentlemen, let's have a great ball game.
So from Central Pennsylvania to Southern California, the Nittany Lions travel over 2,500 miles. For the Trojans, basically a home game, 11 miles from their campus to Pasadena. This is not the first time these two schools have met here. Back on January 1st, 1923, they came together. USC won the game, but the highlight may have been these two coaches. Hugo Bezdik and the Nittany Lions were late, 45 minutes late. Elmer Henderson thought there was gamesmanship. And the Penn State coach said, take those glasses off and we'll fight right here at midfield. Well, Elmer declined, and the Trojans went on to win the game. Penn State scored first on a 20-yard dropkick field goal by Mike Palm, and Bullet Baker rushed for 123 yards and one touchdown. No, Joe Paul was not at that game. And Pete Carroll, across the way, who, when Joe Paterno was named head coach at Penn State, he wasn't born yet. That's when Joe Paul moved on, first as an assistant coach, and then later he became a head coach.
This is the matchup that people wanted to see. Penn State's offense against the athleticism, the intimidation of USC's defense.
And there Derek Williams back deep. One of the more dangerous return men in the country. So we will see if USC will bother to kick off to him. David Beeler has a very strong leg. Frequently he'll nail it all the way into the end zone. The 20 to the 26-yard line. And Kirk, here are the Penn State Taco Bell impact players.
Well, let's start with the running back, Evan Royster. So important that number 22 get established running north and south against the speed of USC. It'll be tough to bounce things. And Deion Butler leads a very talented group of wide receivers. Had a huge game in the last game out against Michigan State. And Derek Williams, the X factor in this offense, number two. You'll see him take direct snaps. You'll see him run as a tailback, as a receiver. He has to touch the football at least 20 times today for Penn State.
He lines up that tailback spot. Frequently he'll motion out. Clark is up underneath center. And Williams touches it for the first time today. Battles his way out to the 28 or 29 yard line with Christian Tupou bringing him down. So here is Darrell Clark from Youngstown, Ohio.
What a great year that Darrell Clark had coming into the fall camp. He was battling to win the job from Pat Devlin. Of course, won the job. Pat Devlin is now transferred out, so Clark has to stay on the field today, stay healthy, and also, as we talked about in the open, make the throws when he has time to throw the football and make some plays with his feet. He is the key to the Lions offense.
Royster moves out to a short slot on the left. With the backfield empty, throws incomplete. It'll bring down the third down. Deion Butler was the intended target there, number three.
Brent, anytime you have a game of this magnitude where there's so much hype, and you're a big underdog, success, early success, so important. And State over the year has had a lot of success completing third down in the Big Ten. This speed and this USC defense, it's a whole different deal that they're trying to deal with today.
The Remington Award winner, A.Q. Shipley, up over the ball. He's the Nittany Lions center. You can see the pressing defense, and they back away. Incomplete and almost intercepted. Maiava. Perhaps the unheralded and underrated of the three linebackers. You don't find three better linebackers than Cushing, Mawaluga, and Maiava, these three of the Trojans.
Yeah, well, Maiava does not get the attention, as you said, as Mawaluga does in Cushing, but the athletic ability and speed that he brings to the table, replacing Keith Rivers this year, has really been appreciated by Pete Carroll.
So Jeremy Boone will punt it away to Stephen Johnson. Stephen's going to try to return it.
down at the 27-yard line. And now, Kirk, let's turn our attention to the Taco Bell USC impact
players. Well, they have a number of players that can make things happen. Stephon Johnson is probably the most gifted between the tackles, and you'll see him out there a number of times having important carries for USC. Damian Williams, the transfer from Arkansas, sat out last year after transferring, has had a huge year this year for the Trojans, and he hopes to be able to stay on the health on the field today, battling an injury with his shoulder. And then Joe McKnight, much like Derek Williams, is the X factor here for the Trojans.
They open with two running backs. Stephon and Joe McKnight, and that is McKnight stepping in motion, and they'll flip it to him immediately. And over there on him is a terrific linebacker. That is Bowman. Navarro Bowman is a young man who could break into the starting linebacking core here with USC. He is that good.
Very athletic. We'll put a lot of pressure today on USC, but tackling in space out in the open field will be important. Mark Sanchez will look to distribute the football, and we touched on Joe McKnight. You're going to see him moved around and within this offense to just get his hands on the football.
Anthony McCoy was 86th tight end, throwing short and underneath to the tight end, out of bounds on that far side. Tony Davis, number 11, defensive back for the Nittany Lions.
USC can attack in so many ways. They're so balanced. They love to start running the football, and then they'll go to the bootlegs and play action to try to get you out of position, and they'll throw to the tight end. They'll throw to the fullback. They'll find the backs out of the backfield. And because Mark Sanchez is so athletic, they'll constantly move the pocket to try to stay away from the pressure of Penn State's defensive line.
That's Stephon Johnson coming outside on this third and four, and backfield empty. Pump fake, not open. Bowman tripped him up, but Sanchez short of the first down. The defenses hold, both of them.
Penn State with some zone pressure here on third down, slanting their defensive line, creating some confusion up front, and eventually the pressure caves in on Mark Sanchez. Huge for the Lions to get the football back early in this game.
Greg Wojnik. Here comes Williams. Fair catch at the 12-yard line, and it'll be the Nittany Lions coming up with their second series of this game. Well, some folks thought it was going to be low scoring. Might be at that. This ESPN telecast available in high definition on ABC HD. No matter what your definition, there's no prettier sight than the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, California on New Year's Day. Fans, Nittany Lions all in white. They bring the fullback Lawler in now. Now they get back to Royster, who breaks to the second level. First down, their best offensive play of the game, to the 29-yard line.
Brent, that's exactly what Penn State has to do, run right into the middle. Here's the DirecTV Ultimate Picture Cam. You can see the blocking up front. Good job of sustaining the blocks, and that gives you an idea of how quick Evan Royster is to the hole and through the hole. That's the difference between Royster from last year and this year, is the burst that he brings to this offense. You have to run through the right to the middle of the speed of this USC defense.
15 yards with his first carry. They leave Lawler in as that lead fullback. And Royster slips into the heart of that D as he comes across the 30-yard line that time. So this offensive line, Lando, Wisniewski, Shipley, Ornberger, Cadogan, this will be the key. 76, 64, 57, 61, and 73. Can the Nittany Lions hang in? Can they get USC into the fourth quarter in a close game?
But the strength of the SC defense is the linebackers in the secondary. If there's one area that Penn State feels they can control, it's the line of scrimmage. It's a long way to go in pass protection and run blocking, but that gives them confidence here these last couple plays.
Three times in a row, number 22, Evan Royster from Fairfax, Virginia. Here are the youngsters up front. Shipley, one of the co-captains, he's the leader. Wisniewski, part of that great Wisniewski family tradition, three generations, all played Penn State. Cadigan, an outstanding left tackle over there. You'll watch these fellows in the trenches all day long. And note the seven up front for the Trojans. This is as good a matchup as you'll see all bowl season long. Taylor Mays, the safety, presses the line now. They expect a running play, and they got it.
One thing to try to control the line of scrimmage, but when you play against USC, you cannot become predictable because then you have linebackers that start attacking downhill. That time, Clay Matthews coming off the edge, Cushing, Maluga, right into the middle of that offensive line, realizing that it's going to be a run on third and short and stopping the line short of the first down.
Maluga coming in from behind made absolutely certain, didn't he, Kirk, that
yes,
Royster
sir.
Was not going to get to that first down marker. Boone punting for the second time here today. Johnson back deep. Stephon Johnson. There are two Johnsons now related on the Trojan team. Fair catch is signaled inside the 15-yard line. Field position staying pretty equal. Your storyline so far, the defenses have the upper hand.
Bowl game presented by City on ABC. Brought to you by City. City never sleeps. The all-new Dodge Ram. Never back down from a challenge. Allstate. Proud sponsors of college football. Are you in good hands? And Southwest Airlines. Low fares. No hidden fees.
Always a great spectacle. There's Cloris Leachman. She was the grand marshal. I have never seen a livelier 82-year-old. I mean,
you know firsthand, big fella.
What a lovely, lovely lady she is. Handoff now is along with Gable. Gable's first carry of the game, and he comes to the 21-yard line. So C.J. Gable, who opened the UCLA game as the starting running back, fumbled, which led to a Bruin touchdown, put USC behind. He never saw the light of day after that. He was a little bit unhappy. But what coaches dislike more than anything in the world, Kirk, is losing the football.
No doubt about that. Probably athletically and physically the most complete running back was C.J. Gable, but we'll see all three of them tonight, Gable, Johnson, and Joe McKnight, and they all have over 600 yards rushing on the year.
Stanley Havili out, an academic problem, and so that means a freshman is in there operating at fullback as Gable could not get the first down, and he's upended by Lydell Sargent.
You've not seen Penn State play this year, and you kind of have the stereotype that it's a Penn State defense from the Big Ten, and they're slow and they're physical. You might be surprised to see how fast this defense can really run sideline to sideline because of the experience that this group has and the linebacking crew and the way they can get penetration, especially off of the edge. It puts a lot of pressure on all the offensive linemen.
He grew up, though, originally back in Pennsylvania. Was always a huge Penn State fan. Gable slashes for the first down. The initial first down to the 31-yard line and Mark Rubin.
Just a great job up front here. Rhett Ellison, the tight end, number 40, gets a push out on Bowman. And look at the seal block to the outside there. The big right tackle, Butch Lewis, does a nice job. Look at this hole open up. Third down. Open it up, and these backs, if you give them a seam, they have plenty of speed to be able to get through there.
And tight end Anthony McCoy knocked Tyrell Sales, a linebacker, off his feet. End around. And they bring Joe McKnight, lining him up. Kirk, just like you said, lining him up all over the field.
They will move him around, and all three of these running backs. I mean, you know, when locally, people are saying, why didn't one guy become the guy? I mean, why have three different tailbacks all go over 600 yards? But they all bring something a little bit different to the table. I think you and I agree, today could be a game, much like last year's Rose Bowl, where Joe McKnight is featured because of his big playability against his Penn State defense.
Coach McNair talking to Gable. McKnight twists, spins, and picks up the first down, apparently. When you compare these two defenses, and you take a look at the numbers, and I'll tell you the one that I focus on, Herbie, USC allowing only 7.8 points a game. Folks, in 8 of their 12 games, they shut out the opposition. That is 8 second-half shutouts in the game. Now, meanwhile, Tom Bradley, who was running the sideline for the defense for the Nittany Lions, now they're pretty good defense, too.
Joe McKnight now all the way at the bottom of your screen here.
So they continue to move in from the gun.
Sanchez has hit fumble. Ball's down.
Pressure from down behind. Do we have the game's first turnover? We have a yellow flag at the 43-yard line. The Nittany Lions think that they have recovered a fumble, and Shaw agrees. Obviously, instant replay upstairs will be taking a look at this play.
I want to see if Aaron Maybin, he got such a good jump off the line of scrimmage. Did he get too good a jump? He's lined up off sides. Possibly 59, Aaron Maybin, the All-American, who had 12 sacks this year for Penn State.
He got offside, number 59 on the defense. That'll be a 5-yard penalty. We'll repeat first down.
USC, a big risk by putting Sanchez back there alone with an empty backfield.
I will tell you, Joe Paterno is furious about that. He had to discipline Maybin a little bit during the week. Took him off the ones, lined him up as the twos. That's inexcusable.
Yeah, it looked like he just lined up off sides, then had the quick jump. Try to take advantage right here. Charles Brown, the left tackle. But as this game continues on, the speed off of the edge from Maurice Evans, 48, and Aaron Maybin, 59, is something SC has to be concerned about. Watch play action and going vertical here from SC.
They don't go empty after that. Keep a fullback and a running back down the middle. Incomplete. Overthrew. So Bowman has come out after that first series. He injured a hand. They taped it. Now they're putting a glove on the leading tackler for the Nittany Lions. We saw the hand being tended to after the first series down below. This was a little bit earlier.
It's a big play he made on third down. Forced the first punt for USC. It's going to take a lot to keep him out of this football game.
Fake McKnight. Close to that first down marker. Sales making the stop for Penn State.
Right now, both offensive coordinators just trying to get a feel of what each defense is doing. In talking and getting ready for this game, it was interesting hearing about how, with such a long layoff, it takes usually a quarter in these big games for everybody to settle down, adjust to the speed of the game, because you can't duplicate that with your scout teams. So right now, Steve Sarkisian, I think, is just trying to get his guys settled down and kind of get a beat on what Penn State's doing.
Galen Hall up in the Penn State booth calling plays across the way. We saw Sarkisian, and we must tell you, of course, that this is his last game at USC. He is the head coach of the University of Washington, and he will go up to Seattle tomorrow. He's already been introduced along with his family up there. And Kirk, I know that you believe that he's going to do an excellent job with the Huskies.
Of course, it's going to take some time to recruit, but he has had an interesting month in this month of December, coaching and getting ready for this bowl game and then switching hats, so to speak, and then going out and recruiting for the Huskies.
Bowman back on the field for the Lions. Pump fake by Sanchez. He got a man open and he overthrew him again. And that was Patrick Turner, the senior from Tennessee, Nashville way, working deep on that far sideline.
That is great discipline from the Penn State defense. And Lydell Sargent, who, by the way, is from California and very excited to be in this game. I talked to just a few snaps earlier about play action and the vertical passing game. That's what SC loves to do. They love to kind of lull you to sleep with the running game, the short passing game, and then they try to get you out of position and they want to go over time for a big play, especially with their speedy receivers.
Williams moves in motion. Fires on that slant close to a first down, and that's Big McCoy, the 6'5", 255 junior tight end from Fresno, California.
from the time that you and I had USC against Ohio State early in the year to where this offense is now, I think the two players that have improved the most would be the big tight end, Anthony McCoy, and I think Mark Sanchez, just naturally through game experience. But McCoy, I think, is now much more confident and a real weapon for Mark Sanchez.
Dancing for the first down and breaking to daylight, Stephon Johnson, number 13.
Well, this is a great picture of seeing Stephon Johnson's strength and why he gets so many carries. The patience, the vision, the cutback, and also he's probably the most naturally gifted back that they have. Does a nice job of just waiting for the play to develop and then bouncing it to the outside and getting upfield for a first down.
Pete Carroll and the Trojans would dearly love to close this drive off for a couple of reasons. And Stephon just picked up 13 yards because Beeler misfired against UCLA three times. Middle, touchdown, Trojans strike first. That's Williams, the transfer from Arkansas.
Sanchez's eyes. He looks off to his left, knowing exactly where he wants to go with the football, and throws a strike to the backside there to Damian Williams. A good job of using the eyes there by the junior quarterback.
Beeler tucks on the extra point. USC strikes first. You're watching the 95th Rose Bowl from Pasadena, presented by City on ABC. To the 95th Rose Bowl game presented by City. USC, winners of the last two Rose Bowls, lead Penn State for the Big Ten 7-0 here in the opening quarter with 4:12 to go. There's the young man who developed into the number one target for Sanchez as the season progressed. And Williams into the end zone for the first touchdown. Beeler's line drive. Rockets out of the end zone. Comes on the 20. Let's go back to the score.
Well, the center fielder, Anthony Scrotto, the free safety right here, is going to work to this side. Damian Williams is here, and he's going to break to the middle. The timing here and how quickly Sanchez gets rid of the football does not allow Scrotto to get back to make the play. That's well-timed and a great execution there by Damian Williams, who's developed into being Mark Sanchez's favorite target. We were talking at the break. This is a very important series if you're a Penn State football player or fan.
Yep. First down, throwing it underneath, and it is complete to Brett Brockett, a sophomore receiver from New Jersey.
See, this is what Penn State has to do. It's okay to want to run the football north and south, but play action pass, throwing the football with Darrell Clark on first and 10 has to be involved in the repertoire today as far as slowing down USC.
That was Darrell's first completion of the game. He's one of three. Play fake and in trouble. Incomplete. Mayava probably didn't see it coming. If he had turned around earlier, yeah. Who knows?
Yeah, you're right. He turned his head, Brent, to look back to find Shuler after he came up. You see him turn his head, and once he does that, he's unable to locate the football. But again, the SC pressure, more this time coming in, deflecting that football and putting Penn State now in third down and short.
Royster not on the field. And that is Derek Williams. Option first down.
This is an outstanding job by Darrell Clark of waiting and waiting to make the defense finally commit down and then dealing it to the outside. Griffin kind of played a little bit of a cat and mouse game with him, making him try to string it out, but he does a nice job of continuing to attack Griffin and still giving Derek Williams enough time to the outside and a little alley there to pick up the first down that the Lions desperately needed.
Taylor Mays continues to play deep center field. Kevin Ellison, the other safety, out with an injury, so Will Harris is also playing. Royster back on the field, works the sidelines on first down. And that was Brian Cushing, another one of the outstanding linebackers for the Trojans, number 10. He'll be playing Sunday football next year.
Starting to see some real battles in the trenches between these two teams on both sides of the ball. That time, Mickey Schuler and Everson Griffin going toe-to-toe there, trying to get the edge. Schuler eventually wins the battle and gets Royster to the corner there to pick up 3 yards.
Play fake, has to throw quickly. Here's Williams. They put it in his hands again for another first down. Moving him around, Will Harris forced to make the play.
They brought the safety blitz this time, Taylor Mays. And Taylor Mays, by taking this chance here, he comes off to the left. He realizes right away Clark does a really good job of gathering himself and delivering the football here, because this happens fast. Mays comes on his blitz. He doesn't buy the play fake. He gets right into the face of Clark. Clark shows the toughness and makes an accurate throw for the first down to Derek Williams.
Moves over to the right side of the formation. Stepping up in the pocket. Penalty flag flies. Wide open is Butler. Butler still on his feet. 20. Remember, there's a penalty flag, however. Butler with a brilliant run inside the 10-yard line, but the penalty marker is down. Nittany Lions have already had one bad break, offside on an apparent turnover. Now a 45-yard play is coming back.
Illegal shift on the offense. Number 3 went in motion before all players were set and never stopped.
Wow.
That's a 5-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
That's the second crucial mental mistake. Not just a play that goes against you, Brent, but a crucial mental error by Penn State. Butler goes into motion there, as you heard, before everybody was settled. So at that point, all bets are off. This play does not work. Great execution, a perfect throw, and bring it back now for first and 15.
You continue to make mental mistakes against these fellows from USC. You back the bus up early.
Yep. They don't need any help.
First and 15 after the penalty. Royster, left side, picks a hole. Gets back just beyond the original line of scrimmage. Maiava, number 43, has been a very active linebacker.
So by throwing Brent on first and 10, which Galen Hall, the offensive coordinator, told us this week, I said, you know, what do you do against this kind of defense? He said, we've got to do what we do, which is be very diversified, attack them. We cannot be passive and hold back. We've got to be aggressive with our play calling. I think this is really the first drive we're starting to see that from Penn State.
Stephon Green, freshman, redshirt freshman from the Bronx, is now in as a running back. He has top-end speed if they can get him to daylight. They play fake. They're going to throw the screen to him, and here he comes. He breaks the first tackle. Gets to the 36-yard line, and Taylor Mays, the safety, the center fielder today, makes the stop. A 16-yard burst.
Another great call here by Galen Hall. And Clark starting to, I think, settle down and make some great throws and some really good decisions here for this offense. And, Brent, you've touched on it. We've watched this young man here, Stephon Green, when he gets into the lineup. He's a great complement to the more powerful Royster. I think he's probably the best home run threat that the Lions have had since going all the way back to 94 when they had Kajana Carter.
Kajana Carter exploded in that Rose Bowl victory against Oregon that day. Here is Stephon. Stays in as the tailback. Time. Slam. Got it. Butler inside the 10-yard line.
This is Darrell Clark in a nutshell right here in the 2008 season. Watch him stand in the pocket. What presence, what arm strength, and delivers an absolute strike downfield into the teeth of the USC defense. Great route by Butler. The ball is thrown to the inside away from Pinkert. Again, I think right now we're starting to see Darrell Clark settle in here for this Nittany Lion offense. Outstanding execution on this drive.
Pinkert, the senior corner, had a fine year. He's out of Oxnard. Timeout is called by Darrell Clark. We'll take a break from Pasadena. USC leads, but Penn State is threatened. Well, coming Tuesday, January 6th, to ABC, by land, by air, and by sea, these are the real stories of the heroes who protect us all. Homeland Security USA series premiere Tuesday at 8, 7 Central, right here on ABC. So the Nittany Lions with a first and goal. They were at the 9-yard line, but a penalty brought that back, and now they have reached that spot again. Clark on a quarterback draw. Set to the middle, end zone, touchdown, barrels in. John Elway could not have run this any better. Kevin Kelly from Langhorne, Pennsylvania. The senior will attempt to tie it up here with his left foot. A huge answer.
Unbelievable job here by Darrell Clark in getting the offense to settle down. A great call, and what amazing blocks downfield. Think about this now. We've been talking about this USC defense being the best maybe of all time. Look at the Penn State receivers and linemen sustaining blocks, getting downfield, and allowing Clark to get some momentum established and then barreling into the end zone for a much-needed touchdown here for Penn State. That's not just a score that ties the game, Brent. That's a score that gets the Nittany Lions to believe that they belong in the same field with USC.
Royster being tended to by the medical staff. He was injured throwing a block on Clark's touchdown run. He moved out and was one of the blockers. It did not appear to be serious when he was shaken up. Also to note, Herbie, I thought that was the first time that the Trojans really missed Ellison as a cleanup safety back there.
Mm-hmm.
Hard hitter.
That's right.
Stepping up into the hole.
Yep. Things get interesting. It's really interesting.
Final seconds of the opening quarter, and there is Kevin Ellison, one of the co-captains, senior from Inglewood, California, unable to play today because of an injury. This will come out to the 20-yard line. Let's go down below to Lisa.
Well, Brent, Darrell Clark, I had a chance to speak to him just last night, and I asked him, you know, Darrell, what are you guys feeling about what they've been saying about you guys not really having a chance? And he said, can I go off the record? And I said, no, I want to hear honestly what you think. And he said, okay, I'll tell you. We're tired of hearing it. We're annoyed. We know they're a good team, but so are we. I know all about the stats. They have impressive numbers, but they have not played us yet. Guys.
Lisa, every reporter should have listened to you when you said, no, I don't want it off the record, because you might have gotten it from somebody else. Good work. First down and 10. Sanchez from under center has time, and coming through now is Ronald Johnson with his first reception, the sophomore from Muskegon, Michigan, as our first quarter comes to an end. Looks like a good one, folks, in this presentation of the Rose Bowl game presented by Citi. We'll return after this message and a word from our ABC stations. To the 95th Rose Bowl game presented by Citi. Penn State 7, USC 7. As we begin the second quarter with more than 20,000 Penn State fans on hand. Almost looks like a whiteout back in Happy Valley, doesn't it? First down and 10 now for Sanchez. Middle complete. Turner.
This is what they love to do. Get you to the outside and then try to hit the seams. The DirecTV Ultimate Picture Cam here gives an idea of what Mark Sanchez can do in the arm strength. When Penn State sits in cover three with three defensive backs dropping deep, there's a seam between the corner, in this case number 11, Tony Davis, and the safety, Scarrato, and it takes a very strong arm quarterback to be able to get it in there low enough and fast enough to get it to the receiver before the safety comes over. Another good throw.
26 yards, Adam Goodman is now in as the fullback. McKnight is the tailback. Play fake, and Sanchez going to keep it in the air. Got another man wide open, and McCoy breaks down to the 11-yard line, and they're having a hard time matching up against the 6'5", 255-pound tight end.
USC clearly has made up their mind to try to get the ball downfield to the athletic ability and also take advantage of the arm of Mark Sanchez. People have talked about Sanchez and said, boy, what's been wrong with him this year, because he hasn't had the huge year. People expecting him maybe to win the Heisman Trophy. But you can see the physical ability and the fact that the talent around him has improved allows Sanchez to be very effective today.
6 of 8 so far for over 100 yards thrown. Now they come back and McKnight on the toss. And the Nittany Lions were ready for that play. And Aaron Maben, who cost them dearly by lining up offside, making the stop. Maurice Evans started in that spot today, number 48, the junior from Brooklyn. If nothing else, the Nittany Lion defensive line, Kirk, is one of the deepest that we have seen all season because of injuries and suspensions.
Absolutely.
Some other players stepped in, like Maben, and developed their games as the season wore on in the Midwest.
I think it's really developed into a real strength. And right now, I think they're holding their own, defending the run. Not so much right now in this drive against the pass.
Yeah, the corners are under attack. He has to dump it off now to McKnight in the flat. And McKnight, with that speed, gets back close to the 5-yard line.
And this is a nice job here by Sanchez. Wants to get it downfield. Last minute, feels the pressure, dumps it to the outlet here. And when you just get the ball as a dump off to Joe McKnight in the open field, it becomes a real strength, because it's so tough to catch him in the open field. He cuts back and picks up so many yards, and also a nice block along the way.
I believe he's shaken up. McKnight is down.
He's had a turf toe that's bothered him throughout most of this year, and you wonder if maybe he's re-aggravated. He's reaching down towards that left foot.
Stephon Johnson, number 13, has already checked in to the game. Sanchez, meanwhile, over on Pete Carroll's sideline. Pete and Sarkisian are talking about it with Johnny Morton upstairs, helping out with the play calling today.
Brent, I think you and I would agree with Joe McKnight, even though there's a good stable of backs here, you lose the home run threat if this is a serious injury or if he has re-aggravated something.
We're going to take a break as the medical staff attends to McKnight, and we'll be right back with an update.
Left toe injury. McKnight walking off the field on his own power, but he took a blow here, Herbie.
Yeah, towards the end of the play, the left foot, you can see, gets rolled. And we'll have to keep close tabs on Joe McKnight. This is a big third down here for USC.
They empty out the backfield.
Here comes another quarterback draw. This one by Sanchez. Touchdown. Both quarterbacks run in for scores. And this one puts USC ahead again for the second time. David Beeler, his holder is the punter, Greg Wojnik. Cooper Stevenson will have the snap. 7-point lead again by USC. The last two drives have both been touchdown drives by the Trojans. Their offense is starting to step it up a little bit. Can the Nittany Lions answer again, though? We'll find out when you come back.
The Rose Bowl game presented by Citi on ABC. Brought to you by Citi. Citi never sleeps. Nissan, who invites you to shift the way you move. Aflac, ask about it at work. And AT&T, your world delivered.
Well, the Rose Bowl went from some of the worst locker rooms that Herbie and I had ever seen to some of the best.
Wow.
Just goes to show you what $16 million can buy you. And now they're attempting to put a knee brace over here on Evan Royster, who went over to the sideline. This would be a major developing story with the Nittany Lions. Stephon Green, the redshirt freshman, would have to start this series, we would think, until they find the appropriate brace. A late decision to come out. Short of the 20-yard line is Chaz Powell as we go back to the score.
Well, USC decides to not even touch the speed rush from Penn State. They're going to use five of their linemen to block two defensive tackles. So Mark Sanchez knows nobody's touching the speed off the edge. I've got to take one step back and then follow the surge of my five linemen against two defensive tackles. If he doesn't get upfield quick enough, it's an easy play for Maben and Evans, but he does a nice job of executing, and right now Mark Sanchez is on fire for this USC offense.
Darryl Clark brings Stephon Green and the rest of the offense out. Stephon, and he is ridden down by Alma. And let's go down to Lisa.
Well, Brent, as you could see, they were working on Evan Royster's left knee. I'm being told that it's a left knee sprain. And as you saw, they're trying to fit him for a knee brace. He is going to try to go back into the game, but he looked very upset on the sideline during that entire USC drive. And he was telling redshirt freshman Stephon Green, this is your time. Go in there and get my back. Brent?
Well, he's out there right now, Lisa, number 21. He's set up behind the fullback, big Dan Lawler. Comes Stephon picking his way patiently and diving toward that first down marker. He's very close. And Maiava, again, number 43, has been the most active of the three linebackers so far.
Well, we'll keep an eye on Evan Royster, but Green is more than capable of carrying the load. But I think durability becomes a question, which means a true freshman, Brandon Beecham, possibly comes in to take some snaps. He's a physical runner. Freshman out of Youngstown, Ohio. Also, Derek Williams is an option if they have to put him in the backfield to take some snaps as well.
Third down and one. Let's see if Shipley and Clark attempt to pick this up. There is Derek going out wide. Short of the first down. monstrous hit by Kyle Moore, the senior defensive end from Georgia.
Well, it is so tough to execute against USC when they know the run is coming. They get a running start. The safeties, the linebackers. Brent, you talked about Moore winning a stalemate there against Ormberger. When you give that defensive line an opportunity to battle and know that that run is coming, it's just too hard to execute. I think the sneak there works a lot better. That play took way too long to develop.
Absolutely. Stephon Johnson back. But the Trojans have scored touchdowns in their last two possessions now. And they're going to have real good field position. Eight trips, and it goes by, and this will take a Nittany Line bounce. A break as it is downed at the 16-yard line. A 56-yard punt as Stephon slips, attempting to make the fair catch. We welcome you back to the 95th Rose Bowl game, presented by City on a beautiful Thursday afternoon. Happy New Year, everybody. 2009, let's hope it's better than 2008, huh? Glad to see that rascal disappear. 14-7. New football and the lead. Quick flip out to the side. Williams, who scored their first touchdown. And now it's time for the Duck. The Aflac Rose Bowl trivia question. All right, folks. Since Joe Pa became the head coach, how many head coaches have the Trojans had since Joe became the head coach at Penn State?
You let me cheat last night.
Yeah, I did.
Is that how we're gonna start off the 09 year? Give me a little help there.
That's absolutely right. You worked long and hard with Game Day. Now we got a personal foul call here.
Yeah.
And that gets tacked on.
Scarrato came in there a little late, close to the boundary. Williams is fighting for some yardage. What you couldn't see there, or hear rather, is the whistles had blown well before Scarrato hit Williams. And so they're going to add 15 more yards. Another mental error here for the Lions in this first half.
Breaking to daylight is Johnson, tripped up at the 40-yard line. Scarrato hanging on, and it looks like we've got another penalty back by the 44-yard line.
Wow, this is outstanding execution by USC.
Might have been a reason for it.
Yeah, well.
Holding.
Except for the hold.
61 on the offense.
To the outside.
It'll be a 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
That's their fine young center, Christopher O'Dowd. Yeah,
O'Dowd locked up on Josh Hull, the middle linebacker. But off to the right side of the offensive line. If they start to have an ability to get to the second level against Penn State, that's where they can have real success running the football. See, Penn State wants to eat up the blocks with their down linemen and then allow their three linebackers and two safeties to corral the ball carrier and chase him down. That's their top five tacklers on his defense, are the three backers and the two safeties.
High and reaching up and grabbing its Turner. Good size on these Trojan receivers. 6'5", 6'1", 6'5", 6'2".
He is all of a sudden really starting to feel good. And I think the game plan has changed with Steve Sarkisian, where now they're thinking pass first and run second. Whereas early in the game, I think they were trying to run the football, kind of establish that and get their play-action pass game going off the run game. Now they're just saying, we're going to take advantage of our athletic ability on the perimeter and attack this Penn State defense through the air.
Play fake. Time. Oh, beautiful turn in by Williams. What a beautiful pattern he just ran.
Brent, this ball was in the air for a full second until Damian Williams decided to come out of his break. Watch to the far left. I don't know if you can see, but the football, look at it, the last second. That's what you see by some quarterbacks on Sunday in the NFL. Ball's in the air. He comes out. Boom, it's on him. So even if the coverage was great by Sargent, the ball is perfectly thrown. And by doing that, it gives Williams time to get upfield after the catch and pick up 35 yards.
From the 20, Sanchez high, and I think the reason why it was high, his back foot slipped as he was setting up as we go down below to Lisa.
Von Johnson and C.J. Gable are going to have to carry the load in the USC backfield. Joe McKnight, I'm told, out for the rest of the game. That sprained toe, the same toe that's been bothering him all season long. He has already gone back to the locker room. Right.
So Joe McKnight, who was their hero last New Year's Day against the Fighting Illini of Illinois, is done for the day. But like Kirk has said, there's talent galore in that backfield. Second down and 10. Quick strike back out to the outside, and that's Osbury's first reception. And he's a 6'4 fella. So you, everywhere you look at these receivers, there's just great size.
Well, that's the dangerous thing here for Penn State with undersized secondaries. Patrick Turner is 6'5. Osbury is 6'4. The big tight end, Anthony McCoy, 86, is coming in at 6'5. And Penn State, you have to make up your mind. Are you going to try to stop the size and speed on the outside? And if you do that, you leave the tight end all alone to work on the undersized safety. So right now, that's a mismatch for USC.
Sanchez has thrown for 179 yards, and he adds to his total, going back to McCoy. So Beeler trots onto the field. Williams was over there congratulating his quarterback on that read on that sideline pattern that they ran. And this is a 30-yard field goal. Tacks on three more. USC's lead is 10, 17 to 7. Well, our Aflac trivia question, how many head coaches have the Trojans had since 1966? Well, if you said a half dozen, you would be, I'm going to say, semi-right. John Robinson had two tours, remember? John
Trick.
McKay, of course, was the coach of the Trojans. Ted Tallner, late Larry Smith, Paul Hackett, and, of course, Pete Carroll. In terms of wins, folks, Joe Paul leads 383 to 367. Absolutely amazing.
It's incredible. Three more years added to his contract.
Drive scooped up by Williams, cuts to the middle, and there's a penalty flag down. This one must have been fairly obvious, huh? There's a couple yellow flags down there on the return.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 25 on the receiving team, half the distance to the goal, it'll be first and 10.
Penn State's made three mistakes now, big ones here. Well, folks, coming in April, relive the majesty of Augusta. Former Masters winners Phil Mickelson and Tiger Woods battle the reigning champion Trevor Immelman for the 2009 green jacket as the first and second round coverage of the Masters comes to ESPN in April. First down and 10 for Clark and the Nittany Lions. Green continues to be the tailback. Royster still out with that knee injury. Clark has plenty of time. Incomplete and a penalty flag. Interference is going to be called on Kerry Harris. He was holding.
He got tangled up with Butler as Butler is trying to get to the outside. As you said, Brent, that'll be much needed break for USC here.
Holding, number 7 on the defense. That'll be a 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
And Butler is one of the great threats in this Penn State offense. Gives a move to the inside for Harris. Harris just locks him up. Ball's pretty well thrown. They still almost completed it, but an obvious call for these officials who are doing a great job so far in this Rose Bowl.
Two penalties against the Trojans now. That's the second, but there have been four against the Nittany Lions. In trouble. Gets it off in time. And he hits Brockett, the sophomore, for the second time today.
This is a good call. This is a very good call. Easy throw if you can recognize the pressure. And that's the second time that Darryl Clark, coming off of a play-action fake, has had to get his head turned around quickly because of either a linebacker or a defensive end is closing down on him quickly. Good job of getting his head around and making a good, accurate throw.
Feeling Moala. Able to find defensive lineman. Gets down in his stance. Clark not going to get the first down. It'll be third down coming up for the Nittany Lions.
Play kind of got clogged there as Codigan tried to come around. There's just nowhere to go because USC got penetration. Darryl Clark has got to become a factor at some point in this game with his legs. We saw him with the big touchdown run on that, the best drive that Penn State clearly has had throughout the game. And other than that, we've really not seen his ability to make plays with his feet. And that, again, at some point will have to come into play to help the Lions.
Hit on the release, and it is fourth down. Cushing, Brian Cushing, the senior from New Jersey. 2 years ago against Michigan, he was the defensive MVP.
Mal Luga gets most of the attention, but what quickness. He gives a little ole there to Ormberger, who's a nasty offensive guard from Penn State, and he has the size to get in there and be able to penetrate, but also you can see there the athletic ability to just get right around him.
Stephon Johnson awaits Boone's punt. Goes out of bounds on the far side. Good they marked there at about the 33-yard line. 17-7, the Trojans. Goal for the third straight year.
Well, coming up on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, we'll be joined by Keyshawn Johnson to break down the first half.
Well, any doubts about Mark Sanchez in this offense at USC? Eliminated. Sanchez is on fire.
Threw a couple of great balls. One anticipated that comeback unbelievably.
All right, it's all coming up at halftime. Right now, let's rejoin Brent and Kirk.
All right, John. And, of course, Keyshawn Johnson was inducted into the Rose Bowl Hall of Fame yesterday at a luncheon. He still holds the receiving record. He did that against Northwestern in the mid-90s. Better than 200 yards. First down and 10. Here's a handoff now to Stephon.
The thing about this football game is you can start to feel the field starting to slant one way and the momentum clearly on the side of USC after Penn State had that touchdown drive, three straight three and outs. Meanwhile, Mark Sanchez just warming up. The success that Sanchez has right now is because they're throwing the football. And the success of running and throwing, that combination is giving Penn State fits. They've got to start to get penetration and get pressure on number 6.
Penetrate and Johnson battles on. So with McKnight out, Stephon Johnson picking up most of the reps here. C.J. Gable, of course, over there on the sideline. And behind them would be Mark Taylor, the redshirt freshman. I should say Tyler. I'll correct myself on that, of course. He's the son of the great Wendell Tyler, who played cross town at UCLA. Goodman
coming off a knee injury as the fullback offset to the right. They're going to roll Sanchez wide open, and he got his favorite target. He got Williams.
USC, this is the bread and butter. Play action, roll Sanchez out, move the pocket away from the Penn State speed, and then go to the second level. You saw Stephon Johnson at the first level. He had a receiver going downfield in Turner just to kind of clear out the zone, and there it's voided. Ball's thrown on time, and you can see the timing between Mark Sanchez and Damian Williams. Today, they are really in sync and feeling good together.
Gable now the running back. Here's Gable, and a penalty flag. Our officiating crew is from the SEC and the BCS games. They always choose a crew from outside of the conferences of the competing teams.
Offsides on the defense. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
Too many mistakes, Irby. This is not like a Joe Paterno coach team.
Fifth penalty now for Penn State in the first half. Tom Bradley, the defensive coordinator, has to be concerned about this because this is just something we've not seen from Penn State. And a lot of that has to do with the team that you're going up against. Start to anticipate counts. You start to do some things that you typically wouldn't do because of the talent you're facing.
Trojans keep it on top, and he couldn't get it off. Our first sack of the game, Bowman. Navarro Bowman, the sophomore from Maryland.
Bowman had to fight to get through here. Pretty good job, actually, Brandon, the pass protection. It was just great coverage downfield. Bowman's going to go up against Charles Brown, the junior, 6'6", 295-pound left tackle. But you can see that he has a tenacity. Just does not give up on the play. And eventually, because of the coverage, he's able to get there and bring Sanchez down.
About 2.5 minutes left here in the first half. Lions would love to have another crack at it. And here is Williams. Off him too far. First down. Cannot give him a cushion like that, huh?
All right, now, we've just seen, and it's a good job of recognizing it by Sarkisian and this SC offense. They're just exposing the Penn State secondary. It's a mismatch at this point, whether it's the speedy Damian Williams or if it's the size with Turner or especially the big tight end. Sarkisian right now really feeling good with his play selections, and they have turned the tables on his football game completely, where they now have all the confidence and the momentum.
Sanchez is 14 of 17 for 211 yards and a touchdown in this game. He's in trouble and going down. Audrick with the defensive tackles. He's in on that play along with Bowman again.
Balance, such a big part of USC and who they are, and they're off to a pretty good start. But you can see the success right now is coming through the air, picking up huge chunks of yardage. But it's important to still run the football just to let Penn State know it's there.
Here's the bad news for Penn State, folks. Eight times this year, eight of their 12 games, okay? The USC defense has pitched a shutout. They have allowed in the second half throughout the 12 games only three touchdowns. It's going to be unbelievable.
Well, it's going to be a tough task, not to mention at some point to get back into the football game, the defense has got to start to make plays and not just slow them down. They've got to create turnovers. They've got to get the football back to their own offense. And you're talking about a USC offense that right now is just really starting to really find an identity in this football game. So you put the numbers up 8 of 12 times, nobody scored a point on them. Right now, I think if you're a Penn State football player, you're thinking, guys, we have got to be able to attack on defense. It's not just a matter of surviving. It's about attacking.
Meanwhile, Pete Carroll wants to go for the juggler here late in the first half. Deep middle and dropped. Incomplete.
Turner had a crack at it and couldn't hold on as he came down. It was close.
They are attacking the seams of this Penn State defense because Penn State continues. This is what they do. This is their defense. They'll drop a safety to the middle of the field and get back deep. Corners to the outside. It creates a huge void, and that's where they're trying to get the USC wide receivers into that seam, that post route that they've had a lot of success with.
And then Kirk Asparino made a fine play, knocking that ball free, or Turner would have had a completion. Under pressure, throws Williams underneath. Williams going for the first down. Got it out of bounds. Still got a minute and a half to work with. That's an eternity.
It's tough to get pressure on Sanchez when he comes back, takes five steps. You get a good blitz, but he still gets the football off. It's a risk you have to be willing to take. You got to like it. You got to like the aggressiveness from Penn State. SC didn't pick it up, but still, Sanchez is a recognition of the blitz and just enough time for Damian Williams to clear, come across the middle, and you can see the speed and why these USC coaches love this young man right here.
Damian making a move on Keyshawn Johnson. Six catches for 118 now. End zone, touchdown USC. Beautiful read, and Ronald Johnson, the sophomore from Michigan. Sanchez is now carving up the Nittany Lions secondary.
We just talked about how they're going right between the corner and the safety, and that's exactly where Mark Sanchez went again. It's an area that I think they came into this football game pretty confident and felt they could have some success. They're splitting the seams, the perimeter of this Penn State defense.
Beeler tacks on another extra point.
This has to be the fourth or fifth time that they've had a receiver work to the post, right into the seam. See, you have one defensive back in Wallace to the outside. The safety unable to get over. Johnson picks up the blitz there from Bowman. See how you have to be able to get back and throw the football with a lot of velocity, and Sanchez has plenty of arm strength to be able to get it in there. And unless you get out of that coverage, Brent, I don't know how you stop that play.
Sanchez is going to have his future evaluated by the National Football League, as will several of these wide receivers, and then they will have a decision to make. And folks, that's exactly how they prepare. It is the loosest football team that we see across this country.
Loosest and hardest working, most competitive bunch that you'll see year in and year out.
Well, a reminder, Tuesday, January 6th, TV's funniest doctors have found a better place to operate, and that place is ABC. Courtney Cox guest stars in the season premiere of Scrubs Tuesday at 9, 8 Central on ABC. And there's John McGinley, who plays Dr. Perry Cox on Scrubs, in attendance here today.
He's fired up. These Trojans looking good. It's the thing about USC, it's not like they work to get a lead and then just kind of cruise on home. No, they just keep pressing. They will not let up.
Here's a memo for the East Coast media. The Pac-10 is about to win the duel amongst the conferences in the bowl games, folks. Pac-10 is undefeated. This would be their last game. This would put them on 5-0. SEC can't catch them. South Carolina lost. You win it based upon winning percentage, and we're looking at a conference that's turning it in at 1,000%. This is not just a statement by USC. This is a statement by all you voters that thought the Pac-10 was so weak this year, and USC never had a chance to climb back toward the championship game. It's why a lot of people, including Pete Carroll, want to see a playoff down the road. There is no better defense in the country than the one you're looking at right here. And the offense not too bad either. Here's Stephon Green. Stephon breaks the daylight. He's got top end. Mays fumble. Loose ball. Trojans got it. Will Harris coming away with the fumble as Taylor Mays makes a big play in the secondary.
Well, just when it looked like Penn State might be able to get something going, Pete Carroll has the game ball already. This one looked like they might have something going. Green gets out into space. And then just another mistake or miscue. Good hustle by USC to be able to get the football. They attack the football. I mean, it's a great run by Green, but they're attacking the football. Ball comes out, and then it's a scrum. And, of course, USC gets it. It's sandwiched here by Taylor Mays from one side. It looked like Kerry Harris, the corner, from the other. I think Harris's contact actually knocked the ball loose.
A 30-yard completion.
They're not done.
For the fumble. They've got 1-12, and Sanchez firing again. Incomplete. So, Herbie, let's go back now and take a look at the four games. Arizona went into Las Vegas and defeated BYU by 10. California in a tough game against Miami. That was up in San Francisco.
But the
Oregon
speed.
In a great Holiday Bowl. Not too sure what to make of that 3-0 score.
It's a win.
El Paso, but a win is a win is,
it
a,
is
win,
a win.
Right?
They really flex their muscles. And for a conference that just does not get a lot of notoriety, you could say what, for whatever reason it is, people nationally do not respect the Pac-10 with the exception of USC. This is huge for this conference.
Stephon Johnson.
Do you get any points for losing every bowl game? Oh, the Big, no, the Big Ten did win. They did win one.
Iowa, huge win over South Carolina. I know. And don't forget, the Buckeyes have got the big win against Texas.
Oh, yeah.
And even though we read these numbers like 8 second-half shutouts, the Nittany Lions will be back to play.
Yeah.
I mean,
they'll never give up on the Lions.
No, no. But they're going to need... You know, Herbie, the one thing that the Trojans have taken away, it seems to me, is Derek Williams as a major factor in this game. I think he has one completion in this game for about 11 yards. And now with the score being what it is, 24-7, they're going to have to strike downfield. They're going to have to find Butler and Norwood, get the ball deep.
Yeah, Butler, I think, is the guy that they've been able to get the football to for the most part. But I think again, if you start to become too predictable, you fall prey. And you fall victim to an USC offense, and Williams has got to be frustrated. This is his last football game as a Penn State Nittany Lion. Wants to be involved, obviously. The game started in a way where it looked like Penn State had enough balance. The Royster injury cost him. But I think USC just made some adjustments, and they've raised the bar in this game. Penn State's not been able to come along for the ride.
Herbie, this is one of the greatest eras by any team in the history of college football. When people look back at the last 7 years and what the Trojans have put together under Pete Carroll, It is unbelievable. They're just a couple of wins away from perhaps winning 3 or 4 national championships in a row.
What Florida State and Bobby Bowden did for 14 years, I thought we would never, ever see it again in college football because of the reduction in scholarships down to 85. What Pete Carroll is doing, I mean, he had 5 players off his defense a year ago who were drafted 3 in the first round. He could have 10 drafted this year off of the defense this year. So the next part of the puzzle will come in next year, and they just don't slow down. I think people thought Carson Palmer left, they'd slow down Matt Leiner. They just go on and on at every position.
John David Booty and now Mark Sanchez. John David Booty was the offensive MVP, I believe, of last year's Rose Bowl triumph.
Yeah, they just
over the Illini. And remember, the last time they lost in a Rose Bowl, and it might have been the greatest Rose Bowl game of them all, was Texas and Vince Young, quarterback scoring with time running out. And even in that game, USC had a great chance. But Reggie
Lindale.
Bush makes a terrible mental blunder with
Lindale
that lateral. And Lindale can't pick up that 4th-and-1.
Yep.
It's just a remarkable, remarkable run by USC. And, of course, with the National Football League staying out of this metropolis, these guys are rock stars out here. Williams is wide open. The corner, Herbie, is off him like 8 yards. And there's a penalty flag also coming in. Little face mask, according to Williams.
Well, this is a combination of a horse collar and a face mask.
Personal foul, face mask, number 1 on the defense, 15-yard penalty. 1st and 10.
Well, A.J. Wallace, about 20 yards off the line of scrimmage, left hand comes in and pulls on Damian Williams' face mask. And we've talked so much about Mark Sanchez, but Damian Williams, 7 catches, 127 yards in the first half alone.
You know, he says that he will be back next year, but I'd stay tuned on this one. and Pete Carroll's very open about it. He says, sure, I want our guys to be evaluated, and if they're going to go early in that first round, I want them to go. Drop off the screen, and here's Gable. Gable running. Daylight got end zone touchdown. They dropped the hammer again, folks. I've seen this movie before.
Big Ten has seen this film before, too.
Beeler adds the extra point.
This is an outstanding call. An even better execution. Offensive line allows the penetration. They get downfield. There's a convoy. And that gives you an idea of C.J. Gable. As much as we want to talk about McKnight and Stephon Johnson, I really believe that C.J. Gable is probably the most complete back. And he gets into the open field. He's nifty enough and explosive enough to be able to get upfield. And this Trojan team, the most impressive thing to me about championship teams, it's when they have a chance to go after you and take advantage and dominate you and go for the jugular, they do. And that's what they've done throughout this entire year, and they've done it again tonight.
Sarkisian's last game as offensive coordinator under Pete Carroll. That's how confident Carroll is about how he runs the operation. He didn't tell Sarkisian to pack his bags, go on up to Seattle, leave now. He said, nope. You deserve to be around us for the Rose Bowl. Come on down, call plays. And over on the other side now, a team that has to regroup here. They've got to tell each other, no quit. Right. You know the chant, we are Penn State. We are now hearing, we are SC. We are SC. Our second quarter summary, and you can see that the Trojans have seized control of this game here in Pasadena, as they have so many times in the past. You know, Herbie, it's just remarkable that the games that Pete Carroll hasn't won over the last few, the little ones,
right,
Texas was
sure.
Huge, but when you think about Stanford, Oregon State, UCLA, but when it comes to a big game, does
anybody
get a team prepared better than Pete Carroll? There's a ton of great seniors out there for Pete on this defense that won't be with him next year. But just like Kirby said, you just plug in some new guys.
Next wave, they'll go.
I don't know if Penn State got the memo, but 31-7 can turn into 62-7 real fast. They better not stop competing.
Remember now, there is an Associated Press vote for a national champion.
Yep. Okay,
they do not have to vote in favor of who wins what should be a great game between Oklahoma and Florida. We had a split championship once before that way, and there's a penalty flag coming down. And that, of course, was when LSU beat Oklahoma in New Orleans. But meanwhile, the Trojans were not invited, and they were voted the AP national champion. So that's going to make this real interesting.
Well, then you have the Texas game, too, against Ohio State. If they go out and play outstanding, there's probably going to be a lot of people who will talk about
illegal
Texas.
Block in the back, number 57 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the end of the run. It'll still be second down.
It's just not like a Nittany Lion football team. They are just so much sounder than this.
You said they've averaged about 3 penalties a game all year. It's the All-American center, A.Q. Shipley, trying to get downfield to help Green out. 6 penalties now. 7 penalties.
Royster's injured, so Stephon Green's the tailback, and Clay Matthews, the stand-up defensive end. And he's from another famous football family, of course. There he is, number 47. One time a walk-on. And now he's one of the starters here at USC. Interesting to watch his future.
Personal foul, face mask, number 47 on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. It'll be first and 10.
Penn State at this point just wave the white flag and try to get to the locker room here.
And one of the loneliest figures of all will be that man right there, because as we understand it, he's going to stay right there in the coach's box. I'm sure he just feels terrible about the performance, because it is so unlike a Joe Paterno team to make the kind of mistakes that they made here. Seven penalties, 62 yards. Let's go to Lisa with Coach Carroll.
Going for the jugular, tell me the importance of those last, not one, but two touchdowns you scored.
Yeah, the sequences have just been just on fire. You know, we've had a chance, and we've really gone for it, and we've been able to make some plays and move the ball down the field. The big turnover really made a difference. That would have changed things a little bit. We're really playing up, you know, and you can tell the guys are really pumped up about this.
Now, Penn State has a pretty good defense. What has been the key for Mark Sanchez being able to just dismantle?
It starts with pass protection. You know, we're giving them a chance. The guys are running good routes, making some plays. Damian Williams had just a spectacular first half.
All right. Thanks a lot, Coach.
Stay tuned now for the Pontiac Performance Halftime Show from the Rose Bowl. Big John Saunders, Craig James, Doug Flutie, and Keyshawn Johnson. After this message and word from our ABC stations. Back live at the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, and I guess a bowl by any other name couldn't be as sweet. This is the granddaddy, the Rose Bowl game presented by Citi. The first half belonged completely to USC. 31-7. Mavalunga coming out, Herbie, for his last half, the senior linebacker, great senior linebacker. Let's go to our Southwest Airlines playbook here.
Where do we start? You know, where do we start with USC and what they've been able to do in this football game? And this is access technology. And Mark Sanchez, early in his football game, had a read and a throw. He's going to look off to his left to try to keep the safety committed to that side of the field, knowing full well that he wants to come back to the right because, again, he has the seam. We've seen this throw a number of times in the first half. The read is great, looks off the defense, comes back, and finds Damian Williams. One of the many times he split the defense and found open space, great throw, and again, outstanding execution.
Look who gets the ball to start the second half.
Oh, man.
Through the end zone, it'll come out on the 20. And let's take a look at Herbie's coaching adjustments brought to you by Home Depot.
What would yours be for Penn State? Show some pride here.
That's what Joe Powell just told me.
Okay.
Show some pride.
There you go.
You got it right there.
There you go. Play hard. Play a full football game. You cannot allow yourself to be embarrassed. And for USC, you're not going to see them let up. If you're familiar with USC, you know that Pete Carroll will continue to go after this Penn State defense. And they'll continue to try to do everything that they can to put points on the board.
Herbie, a couple of football people told me that the corners cannot play off this far against these receivers.
The
They're too good and too talented.
The problem is if they come up, then the receivers go by them.
Completes his first throw of the second half. Ronald Johnson, sophomore from Muskegon.
I mean, Penn State is a cover three defense. They're predominantly a zone defense. They'll mix in some zone pressures, but because you play a cover three defense, and we've talked about this, and we'll show you more in the second half what we mean by that, but you are exposing yourself, if a quarterback has time, to the vertical passing game, to the skinny post, and that's where Mark has had most of his success.
The aerial show continues. Great grab. But the point that the football men, the scouts, made to me when I was out in back and went down to see Joe Pa, is that they're just giving him so much of a cushion that these guys can turn to the sideline, as Williams did there. They can come back into the front. And they said that USC looks at a lot more bump and run against the Pac-10 than they have here.
Yeah, I think the football men might have that as a
maybe an adjustment, but I think if you're looking at what Penn State is doing, typically, I think they're concerned.
Now we're tightening up.
Third and short, third and one, they're going to get tight. But I think they're concerned about the speed, just the speed of going right, a quick move and around them. It's just not what, if that's not what you do, then it's tough to make that adjustment and all of a sudden do that for Tom Bradley. They've got to continue to try to hope that their plan works. And, you know, the big thing is, forget the secondary is getting exposed right now. But, Brent, the defensive line is really getting exposed. Mark Sanchez has had a number of times where he's just sitting back there reading the defense and having time to throw. You've got to somehow get some pressure on Sanchez.
Joe McKnight injured and out, so Stephon Johnson, number 13, and Gable will be the running backs. And busted play, and Sanchez makes the most out of it. Let's go down below now to Lisa.
Well, Brent, I was speaking to Penn State wide receivers coach Mike McCreary as he was coming out of the locker room, and as Kirk said, you know, where do you start? And he said, look, we just told our guys that we've got to keep our poise. We did things in that first half, stupid things that we didn't do all year long with the penalties. As you guys already know, Joe Paterno did not come down to the locker room to talk to the guys, but he did send them a message. He told them to play Penn State football. Guys.
And that has not been the case so far in this game. Making far too many mistakes. 7 penalties, 62 yards. Turn it over after a 35-yard gain. Have a 45-yard run called back. First down, Johnson.
Let's not forget what USC has been able to do here. I mean, we could talk a lot about Penn State's miscues, but I think when you're overmatched in certain areas, you press and you do some things that are uncharacteristic. But SC, their first possession was a 3-and-out. And after that, touchdown, touchdown, field goal, touchdown, touchdown. And the adjustment that they made early was forget about playing this game in a phone booth. Let's get this game to the outside where we have the big advantage with our receivers and our quarterback throwing the football.
Tried to blitz. Sanchez steps away. High, incomplete. Patrick Turner, the receiver, working the near sideline. Sanchez upset that he got that way too high. What's your feeling about Mark Sanchez, and what do you think the scouts will come back? What will they say about Mark? I know you've talked to a lot of folks.
Yeah, I think Mark Sanchez will have the option to really evaluate himself and think about his future, because he's every bit as talented physically as any of these other quarterbacks that might be coming out this year into the draft. But I think if you talk to Mark, he still feels that he can develop and improve. And when you look at around him, almost everybody returns to this offense with the exception of Patrick Turner.
Gable brought down beautifully by Josh Hall. The junior from Milhelm, Pennsylvania, comes roaring in for a big stop.
Yeah, that's a big play there. And here's a DirecTV Ultimate Picture Cam. The penetration we just talked about is essential to these linebackers having a chance to make a play. You eat up the blocks up front with the defensive line, and then you have Hall and Bowman and Sales that have to be able to get the penetration. That time Hall was able to do that, and now you put Sanchez into an uncomfortable 3rd-and-15 situation.
USC 7-of-9 on third downs here today. This one's a toughie. 15 yards he needs. Got a receiver open. And hit him, but it's short of the first down.
Wow, what a
Williams
spot.
Again.
Look at the spot that he got. Sure is. With Damian Williams. You know, he had a separated shoulder against UCLA. There's some people wondering how much would he be able to play in this football game. We saw him at practice. He looked pretty good. But all of a sudden, he is healthy, and he is showing on a huge stage that he's one of the top receivers in the country. The timing, outstanding. He took a shot there on the shoulder and comes up. They got a favorable spot, that's for sure. Pretty much no-brainer what Pete Carroll does here.
You think?
With a smile. You don't just go for it. You go for it with a smile.
Sanchez might just crawl in behind Christopher O'Dowd. He's all Pac-10 center. Fires, hever the guards. quick count, first down.
But going back to your question, Brent, about Sanchez and his future, obviously he'll eventually be in the NFL. And I just really believe that because the entire offense comes back again without Patrick Turner, it allows him a chance to continue to grow, continue to develop. And if you ask him, he would tell you there's still some areas that he feels that he can improve.
They've been nicked a little bit on that sneak, huh?
A little push there with the sneak, pushed off that right foot. It might have tweaked his calf. It's like he was trying to stretch it out.
Gable, the running back. Toss with Gable, trying to get to the short side, and it's clogged up, and he makes the most out of it. They tore it away down there on the sideline. Tony Davis coming away with the football.
The only thing that could prevent this from being a fumble, of course, is if Gable's back side touched the ground before the ball came out.
Did not. That is a clean fumble. Davis did a great job, and Gable's going to be back in the doghouse. Remember I told you earlier, he fumbled on the first series against UCLA. Ball is ripped free in the air. Davis has got it. Timeout.
The ruling on the field is confirmed. First down, Penn State. Play will resume after the media timeout.
Rogers Redding, the coordinator of officials for the SEC, is up here. He confirmed it even earlier. He said, that's a fumble, guys.
Well, first, you confirmed it with that definitive. Oh, yeah, that baby's out. And Rogers comes in.
Well, we do like drama. We don't want it to end the first series of the third quarter.
Hey, never count the Lions out.
Here we go now.
Here they go.
For pride, there's no question. Stephon Green. This is the key replay, and I think you folks can see this clearly at home, that ball was out.
Yeah, it looks like Josh Gaines, the captain, in there stripping that football. Got to attack. I mean, if you're a Penn State player, you're the quarterback, Darrell Clark. Never give up. Keep attacking downfield. Got to make plays.
Royster out with a knee injury. Clark going to try it once, a block from Lawler. Lawler saw the player coming in behind, and Clark wanted him to move downfield.
Well, then he starts to run, and he wants to pick up a block. You got to remember, you're not playing Purdue. I mean, when you point, you better take off, Terrell Clark. Look at Clay Matthews coming from behind to chase you down. He runs a 4-5 coming off the edge. So Terrell Clark has great speed, but so does Clay Matthews, who chased him down rather easily.
USC has pitched 8 second-half shutouts this season. 3rd and 5. Plenty of time. Steps away. Into trouble now. Throws. Got it. And he finally found Williams. Derek Williams had a little daylight, and this is perhaps the best throw of the game under pressure.
An outstanding throw. Clark showing again the presence there, but Matthews does not give up on the play. But what I was impressed with is not just Clark throwing the football, but the strength to be able to be running backwards away from Matthews and then to throw an accurate ball downfield towards the sideline as Matthews is closing in on you for the second straight play.
That's a scary sight, too, with that hair coming.
We saw that at the water.
Here comes Clark with that option look, keeps it, and takes a lick from Mays. Mays moving up from center field. He's another of the youngsters who's going to have his future evaluated. He's a junior. The family's a little bit torn. He's a little bit short of a degree. His mom definitely wants him to come back. And Pops, who played in the National Football League, was telling me the other day, well, we're going to take a few days off after this game, let him get his breath, and then we'll talk
about it. Are you allowed to look that good in your uniform?
No.
I mean, there should be a rule.
No.
He's 6'3", 235 pounds, and he runs a 4.28. He's the fastest player on the USC roster. It's against the rules.
End around now. Derek slips. Derek slipped on the 40.
is going to put more pressure here on Darrell Clark again to execute on a third down and on that offensive line. This is usually where Pete Carroll, Nick Holt work their magic when they get these teams in the Rose Bowl into third down situations. There's Nick Holt, the defensive coordinator. And Pete Carroll, you're going to find it creating havoc on third down. See where they bring the pressure.
Havoc, that's their middle name. Battling in, throws underneath to Green, well short of the first down. Mawaluga picking up the running back. Mawaluga almost certain to go somewhere in the first round of the next NFL draft.
This is a small thing, but again, accuracy important. Throw the ball in front of Green. If you throw it in front of Green, he catches the ball, and it's man coverage. He's able to maybe turn the corner, at least have a chance, but by coming back to the football, Ray Mawaluga way too fast and easily makes the play on Green.
Down 31-7, why not? Got to go for it. Coming off the edge. They've got him from the blind side. Caught by Norwood and steps out of bounds, but it's short of the first down. USC football. That was young Everson Griffin closing in from the backside. The sophomore lost his starting job after the Oregon State game, but he'll be the starter next year.
It looked like he almost knew the snap count. He got off so well. He guessed right, he got the pressure, and of course Penn State comes up short here.
We'll take a timeout.
Rose Bowl game presented by Citi on ABC. Brought to you by Citi. Citi never sleeps. Disney Parks. What will you celebrate? Gillette. Look, feel, and be your best with Gillette's full lineup of men's grooming products. And Southwest Airlines. Low fares, no hidden fees.
Inside the famed tournament house here in Pasadena. Just a beautiful presentation. You go back in history, all the great things that this committee, all these volunteers, they deserve a big round of applause. The volunteers who make this Rose Bowl possible year after year. Shots in, explodes for 11 yards on first down.
Well, with Gable fumbling the football, you know Johnson's going to get more carries. And with Joe McKnight out of the football game, the 13 will get quite a few carries.
How many of you out there would like to see, if USC hangs on here, how many of you would like to see USC play the winner of the Oklahoma-Florida game? Raise your hands.
Uh-huh. The whole booth up here, the whole stadium?
I thought so.
Everybody up here. That's called a plus one, my friends. We all want to see that.
6 minutes. Johnson stopped at the line of scrimmage this time.
Imagine that. Imagine USC looking like this. Winner of the Oklahoma-Florida game a week later.
And that's going to be another. Well, that will be a great football.
It'll be a war. It's going to be a war. Last two Heisman quarterbacks going head-to-head. A good look at Penn State's defense. The struggles here today out in the Rose Bowl against this SC offense that is healthy, clicking.
Second down and 9 for Sanchez and the Trojans. Three steps flat. Got him beautifully, Patrick Turner.
When Penn State goes back to look at the tape of this football game, they're going to see that the slant, and they're especially going to see that the post, both the same concept, movement towards from the outside, coming into the inside. It has been there all day for number 6, and he's taken full advantage of it.
Sanchez has now thrown for 309 yards.
Do we know the record for passing yards?
Got to go back.
Because it's about to be broken.
Ron Vanderkelten.
Keep him in the game. Oh, it's 309. The record is
first and 10. Williams goes in motion. complete underneath. Well, the record was set against Penn State. Danny O'Neill threw for 456 yards.
In a losing effort.
In a losing effort.
Yeah.
But frequently, as you know, the losing quarterback will throw. You
look trying to get back
yards in the NFL. They're trying to get back in the game a lot.
Yeah. Just depends on if Mark Sanchez wants to stay in this game and if they want to keep him in the game, because at this pace, he's going to have a shot.
Williams has 147 of those yards. Right straight ahead, and there is Mark Tyler, Wendell's son, redshirt freshman, missed last year because of an injury, and he has a fine upside. There's a flag thrown on the near side.
Before the snap, false start, number 86 on the offense, 5-yard penalty, it remains second down.
You know, back in 1976, and I would guess that that our friend Dick Vermeil certainly remembers what Pops did in that game. Wendell Tyler ran wild, and Vermeil and UCLA, they'd lost a regular season game against Ohio State and Woody Hayes. They came out and won 23-10, and Wendell Tyler rushed 21 times for 172 yards in that game. Three steps, one outside drop. One of the few drops that we've had today, because Bowman, he rattled Williams' cage, didn't he? Fine football player. Navarro, only a sophomore. He'll be on most of the three All-Big Ten teams next year.
Think about the Big Ten Conference and what it's been through over the course of the last 5 or 6 years in bowl games. Really, the one chance you have as a conference to kind of flex your muscles and show what you can do. And they have been struggling, especially in the high-profile bowl games. And this one will be added to the list.
Third and 11. Drops it off underneath, lets the rush in. Johnson will not get the first down. Set the screen pass with the running back. And the punting team trots onto the field. Greg Wojnik, that's their second punt. And we'll see Williams again going back deep. Derek Williams, he'll touch it again. Maybe he won't. On into the end zone, and there is a penalty flag.
We had Penn State, it looked like they had about 14 or 15 guys on the field, guys trying to get on and off the field, and I don't know if it was that or if it's offsides or what it might be, but there's a lot of confusion there. I think Penn State may be expecting USC to go for it there, but had a lot of players running off the field when the ball was snapped. You can't do that. Oh, it looks like it's on SC. By that reaction.
There was a substitution violation on the offense. They went straight to the line and snapped the ball. That penalty is declined. It'll be Penn State ball on the 20, first and 10.
Wow. But you counted 14 Lions,
There were a lot of guys on that field. Four of them were on the field. Maybe that's why he's so mad.
It's all competitor, folks. Timeout. We welcome you back to the 95th Rose Bowl game presented by City. Well, folks, Rogers Redding, the coordinator of officials for the SEC, straightened me out on this. When the offense jumps out like this, you have got to give the defense time. There were, what, 15 guys out there?
16 or 17.
No, they were
all over that call. Yeah.
So you've got to give the defense time. And he tried to trick them.
It worked.
But it'll be Nittany Lion ball coming out from the 20-yard line.
Evan Royster lost with a knee injury. Now Brandon Beecham, the true freshman, on the field, throwing in underneath the bracket. Lucian out on the field, guard, so some of the youngsters. Landold is still out there. Cadogan. And there you see a sophomore from Lawrenceville, New Jersey. Brett Brackett will be one of the main receivers for the Nittany Lions next year. Second down and five for Darryl Clark. Clark has thrown for 145 yards here today. And Sanchez, of course, red hot with 318 yards. They caught him moving. There's a penalty flag. Beecham's first carry of the game. Freshman, as you pointed out, Herbie, to our audience in the first half from Youngstown, Ohio.
Just like his quarterback, Darryl Clark.
Offsides on the defense, number 26. That penalty will be declined. Play results in a first down.
Will Harris.
Amazing to think this defense has 6 3-year starters. Of course, one of them not playing Ellison. That's why you see Will Harris out there. But the knowledge of this defense allows them to play so fast. 9 defenders invited to play in All-Star games. 5 to the Senior Bowl, 4 to the East-West Shrine.
The 24 unanswered points by the Trojans. Penn State tied it at 7, and now wide open. Butler. Inside the 30 with a nice run after the catch. Deion Butler, the senior from Woolbridge, Virginia.
Deion Butler has come into this football game to compete. He's the fastest receiver that the Penn State Nittany Lion offense has. He looks like he keeps that right knee up, and then he just won't stop. I mean, we saw that in the first half from number 3 in white. Makes the catch. Look at the right knee. He may have touched. Nonetheless, if they go back and look at it, the effort is what I think you have to appreciate. They're going to go up and take a look. Looks like the right knee did touch.
The previous play is under further review.
Should take it back to the 40-yard line. It should be allowed. He's trying to say, come on, man, help me out here. Right knee, Brent. Looks like it touches the ground.
That's when you plead for the NFL rules.
Yeah. But Butler coming off the huge game against Michigan State where he had 3 catches and 133 yards.
Speaking of the NFL, could you believe that 4 road teams are underdogs in the first round of the playoffs? Of the NFL?
You got to keep me up to pace on that. Is that the deal?
Yeah. I mean, the favorites are the road teams. The home teams are the underdogs.
So we have the Colts favorite over the Chargers.
They're going in. Slight favorite. Yeah, yeah. Eagles are favorite up in Minnesota. Okay.
Okay.
Ravens go down to Miami.
After review, the Penn State receiver's knee was down after the catch. Therefore, the ball will be placed at the 40-yard line. It'll be 1st and 10, Penn State.
So that now makes it a 27-yard gain. The other one, Atlanta.
Oh.
Going in. What a year Matt Ryan has had.
Flacco in and Matt Ryan.
Two rookie quarterbacks.
Step it out. This is when I really get excited to watch the NFL.
Yep,
this is when it starts.
Totally agree.
Really good.
You take those Rascals to the playoffs now.
Now it's go time.
First down and 10. Green back in as the running back. With 3 yards on that crease, and Mawaluga playing his final game for the Trojans, number 58. There you have it. A total of 3 touchdowns allowed in the second half. No team has scored against Ken Norton's linebackers and the Holt's defensive front and secondary. No team has scored more than 7 points in the second half against these guys. That's how stout this defense has been.
The adjustments are legendary from Pete Carroll every year, but especially this year with this group.
Second and 7. Hand fighting their way in. Finds strike to the 15-yard line. Penalty flag. Penalty flag on the play. Norwood.
Head to head there. I think he got the better shot on Kevin Thomas, his own player. You got both guys. And it takes a lot of courage to come into the middle of that defense knowing that Taylor Mays is going to come in and take a shot on you.
And Norwood is obviously shaking up here. We'll take a look at this. And
the ruling on the play was an incomplete pass. There was a personal foul on the defense, helmet-to-helmet contact, number two. That'll be a 15-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Keep in mind, Taylor Mays, 6'3", 235 pounds here, as Norwood comes to the middle of this defense.
Oh my goodness.
That's why the rule is there. And I appreciate these safeties wanting to be aggressive, but that's exactly, you see it in the NFL on Sundays. You just can't do that. Cannot lead with your head when a receiver like that is unprotected. Very happy to see Norwood up from that hit from Taylor Mays.
First and 10 after the penalty. Green, crease. Bangs across the 15-yard line, close to another first down.
Nice job here by this offensive line. Being able to get a push there. You see the big tight end, Corliss. And there's Green. I mean, Green has come in here. He's played some football this year. Coming into the night, he's averaged about 5.5 yards a carry, 521 yards on the year. But he's done a nice job picking up the place here of Evan Royster.
So we've reached the end of the third quarter in this presentation of the Rose Bowl game presented by City. We'll be back with the fourth after this message and a word from our ABC station. We welcome you back to the 95th Rose Bowl game presented by City. One of the great ceremonies is the induction of the new Hall of Famers this year, Class of 3. You probably recognize Keyshawn Johnson, who also works with us at ESPN over on the right. That's Chuck Ortman, great star with Michigan in the middle. And Virgil Lubertin there on the left was a longtime manager. Started back in 1972. He's now retired, living in Iowa. Chuck Ortman, who was the star for the Wolverines in a win, lives at the Landings in Savannah. And, of course, Keyshawn Johnson, you see him everywhere now. He'll be on the weekend, Saturday and Sunday, with Chris Berman. They'll be talking about those four playoff games that we mentioned. Here is Lawler, the fullback, his first carry for the first down.
What's interesting at this point in this football game, USC comfortable lead, but we keep talking about how SC has shut out 8 of their 12 opponents in the second half. And don't think right now that's not on the minds of Nick Holt, Pete Carroll, and the USC defense. I mean, you talk about competition and competing, and that's really what they pride themselves on. They're well aware of that, and they want to try to keep the Lions out of this end zone.
Darrell Clark scored the Lions' only touchdown on a quarterback draw. They have a first down at the 10-yard line. Going to take off to the right. Is he going to block down it? Fumble! Scooped up by the Trojans. Moala, the big defensive tackle.
Take a peek at this. It looked like the possibility as Moore was chasing down Clark from behind. Looked like a possibility of his knee touching. Let's take a real good look here.
He might be down.
Yeah, it looks like he's down. How about the speed of Kyle Moore coming from behind to chase him down? And the ball comes out.
We'll take a break while they review it. I think there's at least a 50% chance that they'll turn that one over, but we'll see.
After review, the Penn State runner knee was down at the 5-yard line. Therefore, we will have second down and goal at the 5.
So the Nittany Lions are saved by instant replay, and you can take a look at this, and it does appear, yeah, Kirk, like he was down.
No doubt. what you have to appreciate about USC, chasing him down, trying to get to him.
Nothing easy.
No, they do not want to let him in the end zone.
Okay. Second and goal. I'm sure one of those backers is watching for the quarterback draw. He's going to run it to the short side, and he's short of the end zone. Third down coming up.
It's one thing to have speed. It's another thing to have knowledge and experience that allows you to even play faster. So defense keeps saying it, but they lost five guys from last year's defense, three in the first round. And yet here, this year, with nine senior starters, Taylor Mays, you throw in there. These guys are just a veteran group, and that's why you see the pride when Penn State gets down inside here, and you see that nasty attitude.
We're going to put Clark back in the gun. Williams split way out to the left, top of your screen. Rolling, throw, got Williams. That's where they split him way out, and the Nittany Lions with the fourth second half touchdown against the Trojans in 13 games.
Oh my. You have to appreciate, we keep talking about USC's pride, but Penn State showing a little bit of pride themselves by driving this ball down deep into USC territory. Williams actually knocks back Will Harris before the ball's in the air to find a little bit of an opening in that end zone, and once he makes the catch, he gets hit pretty good but holds on to the football.
Second on the extra point, Kevin Kelly. You're watching the 95th Rose Bowl, presented by City on ABC. This ESPN telecast available in high definition on ABC HD. Well, right after the kickoff, speaking of high definition, we got a high-octane Hall of Famer joining us, Keyshawn Johnson. A lot of folks around Evanston, Herbie, remember what he did.
I know you do.
At the goal line. And Gable is short of the 20-yard line. So, Keyshawn, again, congratulations in being added to the Rose Bowl Hall of Fame. Yeah, 216 yards. That's a wonderful accomplishment.
Yeah. No, it really is. Thanks a lot, and thank you too, Kirk.
Absolutely.
I just, you know, watching this right now here at the Rose Bowl brings back memories. I mean, it's getting a little close, so I'm getting a little nervous. And, you know, I'm trying to talk to you guys that watch the game at the same time. But for me, it's an exciting moment in time in my career. It allowed me to put a stamp on it at the end of the day for me in my college career, and just understanding exactly what I needed to do.
Stick right with us here, and Herbie, we'll see. Sanchez not calling it off. He and Carroll are still going downfield with the strike. Let's go back to that game, and Keyshawn, talk about that brilliant day for yourself here for the Trojans.
Well, you know, this was a football team that come into Los Angeles, and it was a Cinderella story, the purple stadium, and everyone was talking about Northwestern and not much about us, and we felt a little disrespected, and we wanted to go out with a bang, most of our seniors, and we wanted to leave this city in awe of what could happen for the Trojan Nation down the line.
First down and 10 here, Herbie, and there we've got some movement and a penalty flag.
Okay, what's it like being back around the college atmosphere? I mean, you worked so hard on the NFL game, but you and I both know the college game and the NFL game so different. What's it like to be back in the energy?
Well, it's interesting. You know, this is fun. In the NFL, things are about money. It's economics. And when you look at college, you're just out there. You're playing for education. You're playing to have fun. You're playing to make money. Where in the NFL, Brent, there's an investment for the owners. They're investing in players to put them in Super Bowls to fill the seats. So it's totally different in college football.
So after the 5-yard penalty, down the middle again, and he's got him slipped, is Turner.
I want to talk with Key about this play because we have seen Turner, we've seen Williams, we've seen all these guys have an ability. Here's the DirecTV Ultimate Picture Cam. Hitting the seam against this cover three look, it's like pitch and catch for Sanchez with his receiver.
If he throws in rhythm and the wide receiver steps on the toes right there of the defender and closes his cushion, get inside of him, and Sanchez throws that ball in rhythm, can't stop it at all.
And guys, Sanchez now is 26 of 33, 350 yards and three touchdowns. First down and 10. And I know, Herbie, you've talked about all these great players. We're going to ask Keyshawn. As Sanchez got wide open. Touchdown, USC. Ronald Johnson. 45-yard touchdown.
In the middle, for some reason, bites up. McCoy, the tight end, is there, but look at this. Of all the players, USC has had a field day. This time, it's Rojo, Ronald Johnson getting behind, but Scarrato, who's had a rough outing today for this Penn State secondary, out of position. Another easy throw from Art Sanchez.
Keyshawn, these guys are playing like they might want to play the winner of the Oklahoma-Florida game.
Well, they could be playing that in that game if it wasn't for Oregon State.
Right. We'll come right back with Kirk Herbstreit and Keyshawn in a moment.
The Rose Bowl game presented by Citi on ABC. Brought to you by Citi. Citi never sleeps. Chevy, an American revolution. Taco Bell, think outside the bun. And the Home Depot. You can do it, we can help.
Well, USC well on its way to a third consecutive Rose Bowl victory here. 2 years ago, it was Michigan. A year ago, Illinois. And now it is Penn State feeling the sting of this Pete Carroll coach dynasty out here in Southern California. Ball on the tee now for Beeler. Williams is going to come out. Short of the 20, and guys, let's go back.
You know, just a simple stutter go move on a bootleg action, and the corner is looking in the backfield. You can't look into the backfield, Kirk, on a play action, and that's exactly what this corner touchdown.
The corner was confused. In this case, it's Hunt, but also we talked about the safeties. I mean, the safeties, look at Scarrato, even Ruben, there's hesitation, and that's where you have a great running game complemented by the play action and the athletic ability of Sanchez. It just has put too much pressure on the secondary today for Penn State.
Sanchez now with 405 yards. That's a USC Rose Bowl record. Clark back in the gun. Going to go deep down the middle. Incomplete. Now, all time was Danny O'Neill, Keisha, 456 yards, but he threw 61 times. Sanchez has thrown only 34.
Well, close. You get bonus points, right? I mean, you see the Pac-10. You see USC. If they hold up here, nine straight, it's ironic coming into this game, the average margin of victory was 25 points in eight straight. Look at it right now. 25 points again. I mean, what is the difference between, in your mind, I think we all know the answer, the Pac-10, especially USC, and when they take on a Big Ten team?
Well, I think you look at the speed first and foremost. We run a pro-style offense and defense here at USC. And a lot of our guys, they get ready for the NFL for that simple reason. But when you look at teams across the country, that's not what they're doing. We're recruiting kids in Southern California or California in general. We're grabbing the best players in other states. We're going to New Jersey. We're going to Arkansas, grabbing transfers. And that's how we're building this program.
A couple of questions. That was Stephon Green, incidentally, a couple of yards. Keyshawn, I'd like to know how it is that Pete Carroll has been able to put together a dynasty. Now, USC's always been good. Yeah, let's make no mistake, one of the best in the country. But, I mean, when you look back at this body of work by this coaching staff over the last 7 years, it's one of the greatest stretches of any school in history.
Well, you have to buy into the system. And I think Pete Carroll has sold the system, and anytime you're a good salesman, that's what you have to do. You have to sell something. He's sold the University of Southern California. He sold USC. He sold the idea of, guys, you can graduate. You can go on and be successful in the National Football League if you're successful in college. And if not, you can come back to USC, finish up school. Those are all the sort of things that
he's selling to his recruits. Not only that, he's a good person in general.
The thing I've been impressed with, you see the dominance here. Key, the most impressive thing to me, and this is a challenge for every great coach and every great program, is to not allow complacency and the focus on the individual goals, like getting to the league. It's not eroded this program. They keep that on the back burner until it's their time to go. That's the most impressive thing.
Well, I think that is the case. Sometimes you guys will get away. Your Mike Williams, your Wayne Jarrett, they'll get away. But I think when you talk about the things that's going on with this program, it's just teaching them, if you play at the level that we're asking you to, then you'll be successful and you'll have an opportunity to get that money.
We saw Cushing in on another play along with Will Harris on that. Keyshawn, I want to, because we talk about the great talent, and I know that you have an idea after this play, we want to put up a graphic where you think some of these Trojans will be drafted. I know that you follow the NFL closely, and how high the bulk of these defensive stars might go in the next draft as Clark tries to throw it downfield. And Butler makes a fine play. And let's take another replay look at this one.
Well, this young man has been making plays this entire game for Penn State. Really, the one area that has shined is when number three has been able to make plays. He sets him up to the inside, comes back. Actually, Harris loses him. And once the corner loses him, Clark delivers the football, takes the shot at the end, and it's another shot up high, this time by Clay Matthews, who seems like he's been in the backfield of Penn State the entire game.
That's a 35-yard gain. We see that Graham Zug, number five, is out to the left. Dion averaging 30 yards a catch here today. Clark coming down the near side, incomplete and out of bounds. Now we go to Keyshawn's list and tell us about it.
Well, I think you got it right. I think Ray is a number one pick. Clay Matthews would probably have climbed his way up to the second round. Brian Cushing, depending on how he'll test, will depend where he goes. I think Kevin Ellison, he's probably a second, third round guy there. And as you go down, I think Patrick Turner has the ability, and he's played well the second half of this football season, has the ability, depending on how well he runs, to climb into the second, middle of that second round, high third round type situation for himself.
Second down and 10. Here is Green. Breaks free. Great speed. Can't split the last two defenders. And he's down at the 15-yard line. Herbie, take a look at this one.
Yeah, this offensive line hasn't had very many moments like this, but it started in the backfield. Watch him be able to slip off of a tackler. In this case, it's Matthews. And then that's the acceleration that Green can bring to this offense. You have Royster coming back next year, and also Green coming back for this Penn State offense. Once he got away from Matthews, it was great blocking downfield, especially at the second level.
And, with USC in the talent level, there are some juniors that's talking about coming out of school. I'm not a strong advocate of juniors going into the NFL.
Why is that?
Well, because, first of all, they really can't help a football team. They're young and they need to stay in school.
Clark in zone, got a man open, and he missed him. He had Brett Brackett down there, and he could have rung up six.
Brackett slides down the sideline. You see him. He's coming right towards you. Williams breaks to the inside. Little wheel route down the sideline. And Clark, anticipating Brackett being open, just overthrows him.
Keyshawn, what's your feeling about Darryl Clark as you watch him against this great defense?
Well, I think this defense is one of the best in college football's history. It'll go down as one of those defenses. And I think he's done a tremendous job at times of getting his receivers the football. But you have to have balance against USC. You have to run the football like an Oregon State and then put the football in the air. So right now for him, he's doing a pretty good job.
There's Williams. Hit him with that quick pass outside. Maiava's played just an outstanding game. It's so nice because he doesn't get the publicity that Mawaluga and Cushing get, and it's nice to see him.
Well, I had a chance to talk to him at practice the other day, and I told him to cut his hair.
Oh, did
before
you?
I cut that hair. He says, "No, this is what gives me my power."
I bet you didn't talk to Mawaluga.
Ray,
no, I left him alone. That's it. He's a little big.
Third down and three, and that's the fullback. That was Lawler. Danny Lawler gets his second carry of the game. But a timeout. Before that snap, See, Petey sees it. He sees it. Give me a timeout. Give me a timeout.
He has fun out there. Yeah.
So we'll take a break and be right back.
Well, a reminder that Sunday NFL Countdown presented by IBM on both Saturday and Sunday with the playoffs coming, 11 a.m. Eastern, host Chris Berman, all those analysts, Mike Ditka, Tom Jackson, Steve Young, Chris Carter, and, of course, Keyshawn Johnson has been added to that team, and they'll give you all the insight as we approach doubleheader Saturday and doubleheader Sunday. And here is Clark on a pitch to Green, and he is knocked down by you-know-who, number 58, Ray Mabaluga.
About the speed of this defense, and here's a great look at number 58. And can you look at him close in on this?
I mean, he just plays with flat-out speed all the time. And look at Pete. Oh yeah, go get him.
They sent Kevin Kelly out, the field goal specialist here. So they're going to let him attempt to tack on 3 points at the Rose Bowl. 7:27 to go, 25-yard field goal. He's been a fine kicker. And this is his last game, so that means a lot. And Keyshawn, thanks for dropping by.
No problem. Anytime.
Good luck with those rascals over the weekend.
Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Right, congrats.
We'll be right back. We welcome you back to Pasadena as we take a look at our City Rose Bowl game summary. And you can see that 24-point second quarter. That appeared to doom the Nittany Lions there. Scoreless third quarter, Herbie, and then the Nittany Lions have outscored them here in the second half, 10-7. This is the most points that this defense has given up in the second half.
Unacceptable.
Everybody was expecting the onside kick, and this is fielded by Johnson, Ronald Johnson. Steps out of bounds. And folks, help decide the Pontiac game-changing performance of the year. Go to ESPN.com, search Pontiac to vote. There's four marvelous plays in there. Of course, Herbie, I know the one that you and I are biased toward because we were there that night in Lubbock.
Yep.
When Michael Crabtree, the second to go, cost Texas a shot at the Big 12 championship and then perhaps a berth in the
absolutely
in the BCS championship. And
maybe
that's
Cole,
how big that
maybe
that
Cole plays. McCoy the Heisman Trophy. Mm-hmm. A number of things were settled on that one play.
Sanchez is still there, and a fine play by Bowman. Here it is, Herbie. No, you'll never forget this.
Oh, this was amazing. Just the clock's running down. You're going to think he's going to go out of bounds. I mean, this is one of those plays 15, 20, 30 years from now. If you saw it, you'll never forget where you were or the impact of that game as the Red Raiders all of a sudden became a huge story, and not just the Big 12, but the whole nation.
So, again, to go back on how the conferences are faring in the bowl games, the Pac-10 about to go 5-0, and they will be the winner based on winning percentage. And no one else can wind up with three games and be batting 1,000. The SEC lost today. South Carolina beaten by Iowa.
In my opinion, Brent, with non-conference scheduling heading in a direction that I think most of us as fans don't like to see, I mean, you rarely get to see those great intersectional games. It seems to me the bowl games are the chance for conferences to really show where they stand.
Right.
Some of them take advantage of it, some of them don't.
We'll take a break and be right back. With Kirk Herbstreit and Lisa Salters, I'm Brett Musburger. It's always an honor to come and broadcast the Rose Bowl game. Herbie, I know that you feel about this venue just like I do. There is nothing better. I know that USC is about to become the first school ever to win three straight Rose Bowl games as they close in, having beaten Michigan and Illinois, and now it'll be Penn State. Stephon Johnson. And, you know, a lot of coaches have tried through the years, but only Pete Carroll's been able to win three in a row. John McKay, Woody Hayes, Pappy Waldorf, Bo Schembechler, Don James, And now it'll be Pete Carroll, and might have won four in a row, except for a fellow by the name of Vince Young.
You run out of things to say about Pete Carroll and USC. It's like watching Tiger Woods play golf. I mean, they're just so dominant. This will be nine straight games. They've now beaten the Big Ten by an average margin of 25 points. As I said, it was by an average margin of 25 points coming into tonight's game with eight straight. So they decided to match that number tonight just for fun to make it now nine straight.
This is a fourth down punt coming up. Under pressure, Wynette gets it off. And they're going to let this one roll down.
You know, we had a lot of fun at the director's dinner the other night. And there he is, ladies and gentlemen, Cloris Leachman.
That was wonderful.
Dancing with the Stars. Look at my man, Brent.
That was my first shot to dance with a real star. What a gracious lady.
You were out there. We thought maybe one dance. He waited in the line like a 13-year-old, about five deep, and we thought he's going to get impatient. But no. You waited the 20 minutes to get your turn.
You know who's laughing the most? My wife, Arlene.
But you waited your turn. You
yes,
got
I
in
did.
Position, and then
yes,
you
I
went.
Did.
We thought he's not going to go for one dance. Sure enough, you did the one dance. Then they went a little bit of up tempo on you,
yeah.
And you did the second dance.
The second dance.
And you guys just had a great time. And by the way, Dancing with the Stars.
Here comes Williams now.
Which she was a huge hit
right.
On the last series. It starts again. Season 8 will be coming to ABC on Monday, March 9th. So I don't know if you want to. I don't know if you want to look at my man here. You should have seen him now. Here is a campaign if I've ever seen one.
They had that wonderful Napa wine down for me, and that made it all.
I mean, you were going slow. You were going fast.
Herbie, I'll get you. It'll be next season, but I'll get you, my friend. There's Corliss, the fine tight end, picking up another first down. So the first team to score more than seven, as we told you a short time ago, in any second half. 13 games in. Herbie, it's just unbelievable what they have accomplished. And they misfire on it.
I think the biggest difference, we keep talking about SC versus the Big Ten, the thing that I see, and I think people miss this, they think it's speed, as in just the receivers and the skill of these teams. I see a difference in the speed of the linebackers, the defensive linemen, the offensive linemen. When I say there's a difference in speed between USC and the Big Ten, that's where I see it. I mean, that's where there's a huge upside, huge advantage for the Trojans against these teams they face.
Second and 10 now for Clark. Wide open, Norwood. Remember that hit he took earlier? That helmet to helmet, back out there with the reception, picking up the first down. Mays, that time made the stop again.
He took another hit here. It's a veteran group of wide receivers that Penn State will be losing. Derek Williams, Deion Butler, and Jordan Norwood. And Norwood here takes a blast and just keeps going. He's up taking another big shot.
Here comes Green. Good balance. He's slipping, coming through that line, pushing, wrestling it down inside that five-yard line, though.
A nice burst, about 195 pounds, freshman out of the Bronx. Looks like he's down now.
That would be the second running back to go down. Evan Royster injured his left knee in the first half early in this game and has not returned. Royster had carried six times, Herbie, for 34 yards when he was injured, and now it's Stephon Green, and that would be Brandon Beecham coming back. And so a reminder to all to stay tuned after the game for Americans' funniest home videos over most of these ABC stations. And, of course, over on ESPN, there will be a SportsCenter football special And we'll hear from the coaches and some of the players. We have highlights from all of the bowl action today. Am I right? Nebraska?
Did Nebraska end up?
Did they get a win over Clemson? Yes. George Hill and Brian Mulvison, they've been in charge of following those games for us. We want to thank them. And how about your guy, Darren Brown, over here?
Doing a heck of a job.
He done a heck of a job. He helped me with the bus driver negotiate a couple times.
That's his wheelhouse. Any kind of negotiations.
Yeah. A little short. That's fog coming in, isn't it? Did somebody tell me the other night that there was a serious fog in San Diego? Did you say that?
Yeah. You mentioned that. Right, as I said, about 5 or 10 minutes right after the game.
Right after the game, after the Holiday Bowl that they broadcast down there. Big win for Oregon in the Pac-10, and there was a movement down in the trenches. Now, this has been some bowl season for the Pac-10. Tom Hansen's
before
last year as commissioner. We certainly
start, number 64 on the offense, 5-yard penalty. It remains second down.
We want to wish he and his wife nothing but the best in their retirement.
Yep.
He's been a great friend through the years.
What a way to go out with this conference.
Oh, yeah. 5-0.
5-0 in bowl games. You can't beat that.
Second down. Slant. And the receiver fell. Was he pushed? Incomplete. No flag down.
USC that time just playing straight man coverage.
That's Pinkert. Remember the coaches told us that he played very, very well.
Yeah, a senior who has battled through so many injuries. Tore his ACL in his left leg, came back, battled through that. Tore his ACL in his right leg, battled through that. He's had a lot of injuries, but his senior year showing the NFL and, more importantly, helping his team be a complete defense opposite of Kerry Harris is a solid corner.
Third and eight now for Clark and the Nittany Lions. There was movement, it looked, by that defensive lineman. There's the flag. He throws it in for a touchdown. Norwood caught it. I thought the defensive lineman jumped, but we'll let them sort this out. If it was, it's a touchdown, and the Nittany Lions playing much better in the second half.
Offside, number 93 on the defense. That penalty will be declined. Touchdown.
That's Everson Griffin. He timed one perfectly in the first half, but not this time.
Not this time. Free play for Darrell Clark. And again, for the second time here in the second half, not only do they score a touchdown, but they have success throwing to Clark's left. Nice move by Norwood, who the coaches would tell you, of the group of receivers, is probably the best route runner. And he finds a little seam there, comes up with a score.
Well, the bowl cup challenge standings, we in Pac-10, you can see unbeaten coming into this game, about to go 5-0, and again it's based on percentage, so that would crown them the champion. The Big East 3-1, Conference USA and Big 12, SEC, all playing well.
I think you got to look at the Big 12 there, sitting at 3-1, still three games left. Really, I mean, I know we're caught up in the Pac-10, and for good reason, they get 5-0, but I can't tell you how many times you and I did radio shows throughout the year and heard people say, oh, the Big 12's overrated, it's average offense and terrible defense, and so far, still a long way to go. So far, they're showing that
somebody actually said average offense?
Yeah, I heard that a lot.
You got to be kidding.
Even defense, guys on our own air would say the defenses are horrendous. And it's just...
I can see wondering about the defenses, okay? Because Oklahoma State didn't hold up against Oregon.
Right.
And I can honestly listen to that chatter.
Yeah. The chatter about the...
Well, they're just playing wrong about the offense.
Of course.
It's not even close.
Right.
They've got great running backs,
great
wide receivers, and the best quarterbacks in the country.
Maybe we've ever seen, top to bottom.
I think, Kirby, now a lot of people will probably disagree with me as Kelly kicks this off. It's a 14-point margin right now. It goes in. I'm starting to think that quarterbacks may be more important in the college game than they are in the NFL. Yeah. I'm not putting them down.
No. It's the system.
Yeah.
It's the way the game's evolved to change.
And a reminder, we'll all be watching this in April now, the majesty of Augusta. And again, the first and second round coverage of the Masters will come in April on ESPN. Now, I believe I was told by the executives that they will show it live during the afternoon and come back at night. So many people who are working love to see the replay of it that night. I was wondering, at Augusta. I always did that.
ESPN did a great job of getting wall-to-wall coverage. And it's great to see a Masters promo. That means we're close to getting out of the winter, at least getting there.
Coming underneath to Adam Goodman handling the ball. It's an interesting question, Harvey, because with Keyshawn up here, we talked about first-round draft choices with USC. But as you look across the board with Penn State, I see some offensive linemen that may go hot.
Yeah, I mean, you see some linemen. I mean, this is a veteran group. Derek Williams, Deion Butler, Jordan Norwood, the receivers, they're all going to get looks in the league. But on defense, most of these guys all come back with the exception of Aaron Maben, who's a defensive end who has to make a decision. Todd McShay feels that Aaron Maben is one of the top defensive players out there. And I think I look at that and I see a lot of great players, but with Aaron Maben, and just my opinion, he's got a lot of growing to do physically and just maturing. We just talked about that with Keyshawn Johnson. He's only a sophomore, redshirt sophomore.
I totally agree about Maben. Haven't seen, been up close to him in a practice field. He would be making a huge mistake.
Yeah.
A huge mistake. He needs to develop and grow a little bit more. I don't think some of these youngsters know how physical that is at the next level, or what they're stepping into. Is the timeout has been called by the Trojans. I mean, I hate to see the youngsters leave early, you know? And I got to tell you what I think is really underrated by a lot of the scouts, and that's Tim Tebow down in Florida. I just think the youngster is a winner in a bad organization situation. Let me take Detroit. They've got the first one, right? Yeah, obviously. They didn't win a game. You get somebody like Tebow in there rather than a pure pocket passer, he can create so many things for you. Run when he's in trouble. You haven't got a great offensive line. I don't know what you think about Tim Tebow, but he throws well enough for me.
I think if he were built differently and didn't run over the top of safeties, people would have a better appreciation for his ability to throw. But the intangibles to me of that position,
unbelievable.
He's kind of created a new platform as far as I'm concerned when it comes to intangibles. So, you know, Sam Bradford, there's talk about him coming out a little bit more of a prototypical NFL-style quarterback, although he'll have to learn to get under the center and take snaps. A lot of people feel that he'll come out, and between he and Matthew Stafford, the quarterback at Georgia, could be one of the first picks overall in the draft if they decide to come out.
How about these Nittany Lion fans here?
Never give up.
3-14, and they are just hanging tough. Johnson battling. You have to give the Nittany Lions a lot of credit for playing this second half with a lot of pride.
Remember my second half adjustment? Play for pride. And that's, you talked to Joe Paterno upstairs. That's the same thing that he said, and they've definitely done that. Obviously, USC has changed.
These Nittany Lion fans want another touchdown right now.
Yeah.
They want to close down here. They want to make this a 7-point game. And well, USC dominated Ohio State second week of the season. Mamaluga intercepted and scored on a touchdown in the first half. They were number one in the country. Penn State with a tough game in Columbus. Fort Reuben forcing that fumble. And the Nittany Lions upset the Buckeyes. And then Texas Tech shocked number one Texas down in Lubbock that night on the Crabtree grab. Talked about Bradford leaping to the Heisman against Oklahoma State. But there's been no better symbol of effort and courage and how to play the game than Tim Tebow, leading the Gators into that BCS title game. And what a dandy that figures to be now. And I tell you, I have never heard a team, group of fans, trailing like they have been, who are as alive as these Nittany Lion fans. I mean, they want this other touchdown.
Sure do.
This one's real right now. Fair catch by Derek. And of course, right after the game, we'll have Rose Bowl postgame coverage with John Saunders, Craig James, Doug Flutie from Pasadena. They'll have the Rose Bowl trophy presentation. They'll have the offensive and defensive MVPs. They'll make that announcement. Three-minute, the Nittany Lions, Darrell Clark. And look at the effort on the other side. Sanchez trying to rally the troops. Right now it's a 14-point game. Hit on the release, and it's intercepted. Picked off as the receiver goes down, and it was grabbed by Will Harris.
A nice job here, the stunt. Clay Matthews, who again seems like he has been in the face of Darrell Clark this entire game, over the tight end, and then works to the inside, and the offensive line loses him. See him cut, work to the inside? The back, I think, and he's a young back, Brandon Beecham, probably should have picked him up and instead released as an outlet, allowed Matthews to get in there, and there's an opportunistic defense, seeing a ball that's tipped and somebody coming up with a catch, in this case, Will Harris.
Corliss is the receiver who slipped. Here's Stephon Johnson. And he is thrown down by A.J. Wallace.
Now, if you've watched the entire football game, I think you have to respect what Penn State has done, but also realize that the game plan and the approach from USC has changed. Up 31-7, things changed a little bit offensively for USC. Sure, they kept attacking and kept trying to put points on the board, but not with the same severity and enthusiasm that I think they did in the first half. But in my opinion, you don't take anything away from what USC has accomplished. They've dominated this football game. With that said, you put an asterisk next to that and tip your cap to Penn State for not quitting and coming back and at least trying to make it respectable. I don't think the debate will be about USC and the AP personally. When all the bowls are over, I think if there's any debate, it's again going to be if Texas really works Ohio State and Oklahoma beats Florida. I think that would become the big debate. And how ironic, it's Texas and Oklahoma yet again, and another debate for the AP.
Third and eight for Sanchez. Had a 400-yard passing day, handing off to Stephon Johnson. You know, we talk about Mark Sanchez, and reminds me that here in Los Angeles, they've got almost 5 million Latinos live here, and many of them are Mexicans, and they have really elevated Mark Sanchez to star status here. He's a hero with the Mexican-Americans, and I know that his father, Nick, encouraged him to take an advanced Spanish class, and that's so he could conduct interviews with the Spanish networks here. And he's closing in on another win, which would make his record 14-2 as a starter. He's just an outstanding young man.
And I talked with Steve Sarkisian a lot this month about Mark Sanchez, and he said, you know, we probably put a lot on him this year. We had an inexperienced offensive line. We weren't consistent enough running the football. Put a lot on him, and it slowed his process down. But he said, as far as his physical ability, you put him in that Carson Palmer type of physical ability with the athletic ability, the arm strength. He also said mentally, they do more at this point with Mark Sanchez, this is according to Steve Sarkisian, than they did with Matt Leinart or Carson Palmer, as far as checks at the line, controlling the run game, controlling the pass protection, getting in and out of plays.
Well, as for the Big Ten, they still haven't won a Rose Bowl since 1999. That's when Barry Alvarez in Wisconsin beat Stanford and Ty Willingham. Penn State came into this Rose Bowl having won three straight bowl games and nine of their last 11. But Pete Carroll is about to become the first coach to win three consecutive Rose Bowls. Over his head. Nittany Lions with a chance here in the last 30 seconds. Cooper Stevenson.
Just a snap.
This one just a little high.
I mean, that is one of the few mistakes we've seen from USC. Stevenson just... That ball flew. That was a good 4 or 5 feet over top of the punter, wasn't it?
Penn State without a timeout. Picking up 37 yards on that missed snap. A lot of folks in Nevada are on their feet. First down and 10. Tried to get it off. There was Matthews again and Kyle Moore. So you've got both of them. Moore, number 84, Matthews, 47.
They brought Maluga as well. Moore has had a great football game, and there's 47 again. Clay Matthews.
Norwood checks in. Seconds to go now. Complete to Butler, but Butler is going to be well short of the end zone. But they don't have any timeouts, sure. And Harris was there, wasn't he?
Yeah, Harris came to the outside, used the leverage to make Butler go back to the inside to keep that clock moving. Nice play there by Kerry Harris.
Here's the third down. Stops the clock to give himself a fourth down here with 7 seconds to go. They'll be thrown into the end zone on this. The wheel's still turning here. Remember the Rose Bowl presentation right after the game down on the field?
Clark has had some success. Last couple times they've been down here throwing to his left, finding Derek Williams and also Jordan Norwood.
Now, USC was a little bit concerned about him rolling left. Mm-hmm. They mentioned to us that they had seen on tape that he can still throw pretty well going in that direction.
Dead ball, delay of game, number 17 on the offense, 5-yard penalty. It remains fourth down.
Probably not going to change the play call here for Darryl Clark and Penn State. Again, let's see if he looks to his left. He's got Butler, who will be at the top, and Norwood in the slot.
Throws a lob to the end zone. Jump ball intercepted. Threw it up for grabs into Harris's hands. Three in a row for Pete Carroll and the USC Trojans. First time in history. Steve Sarkisian hugs his quarterback before he goes to the airport and grabs the next plane to Seattle. Mark Sanchez throwing for 413 yards here today. A USC Rose Bowl record. And a long day for the grand old man, Joe Paterno. Let's go to Lisa.
Thanks a lot, Brent. You're shivering a little bit.
I'm
you just
right.
got
I'm
the Gatorade.
Right.
All right. Now, Coach, I know the game was pretty much out of hand, but what were you thinking when the ball went sailing over your punter's
head? Oh, I lost my mind for a moment there. But we stopped them. You know, we got out of there. Defense came through for one last time, like they've done all year long. This was a great opportunity for us to have a big-time matchup and get a win. I love this win for us, and we're really, really thrilled about it.
So here we are, another Rose Bowl, another dominant USC performance. What was the difference, do you think, in this one?
I think the offense was on fire in the first half. I thought Mark just set the tempo. Damian Williams came through. Patrick Turner, the O-line really protected well, so we had a chance to really get moving on these guys.
It was that 24-point second quarter. How were you guys really able to just change the game?
Well, I don't know. Over the years, we've hit it. When all of a sudden we go, you know, and we just kept firing on all cylinders, and the defense kept giving the ball back, and our guys just took advantage of it. It was really a cool burst for us.
We always talk about the speed advantage. In your mind, how did that really manifest itself tonight for you guys?
Well, I don't know about that. This is a great football team, you know, that we just played. I think our execution, throwing and catching, was really there tonight. It really came through. I don't know that we outran them at all, but we certainly just saw plays on defense where our guys ran them down in some nice fashion.
Now, I know this is a hypothetical, but what would you guys give to be able to play the winner of next week's game?
You know, well, we would love to do that. I don't think anybody could beat us. You know, I just feel like that's what this team is all about. We can do whatever we need to do, and unfortunately, we don't get to, but maybe someday there'll be a chance, but not now.
All right, thanks a lot, Pete. Congratulations.
See you, Lisa.
Brent.
Lisa, thank you very much, and we'll return with our Rose Bowl post-game coverage right after this message.
Great. You know, get to see these guys.